Good afternoon and welcome, everybody. This would be the Jeff Cameron Show right here on 97.9 ESPN Radio, and it is great to be with you. Good Monday. Hope you enjoyed the weekend. Big game tonight. Great games over the weekend. Good games over the weekend. Certainly something that occupied our sports-loving brains for a little while on Saturday and Sunday, right? Online, ESPNTallahassee.com. You can find us there. You can find us on the radio. You can find us on YouTube. Hello, YouTubers. You can email us if you like, JCS@979ESPNradio.com. All guests appear via the Phone Hero Hotline. Phone Hero specializing in iPhone and iPad repair. Two locations, 2915 Cary Forest Parkway, 833 West Gaines Street. Online at PhoneHeroTLH.com. All right, so tonight right here on these airwaves, let's get this out of the way from the beginning. We've got the game for you. So if you're in an unfortunate set of circumstances where you have to work and you want to listen to the game, you can right here on ESPN Tallahassee. You can also, you know, if you're driving around for any reason, if you had this terrible moment in which you had to run an errand as they kick off the college football's national championship, that's a toughie. But you could hear it. You'd be able to listen to it right here. So that's good news.
We need soap. Okay.
Yeah, well, we're going to go ahead and use some dish soap until tomorrow, honey, because I'm not missing the football game. The weekend that was has to begin, though, not with the NFL and the three games that were played on Saturday and the three games that were played on Sunday, concluding late last night as Cleveland hammers Pittsburgh and puts an end to the Ben Roethlisberger era in Pittsburgh. But rather what happened here in the transfer portal for Florida State football, and this is something that we suggested was going to have to be mined closely, and something that could serve as a bit of a relief and certainly an upgrade at key positions on this roster so that Florida State gave themselves a fighting chance to improve and improve right now. Not 2 and 3 years from now when you develop kids in this recruiting class that are coming out of high school, but kids that can come in and play a role for you in this upcoming season and help bridge the gap between that development that has to take place for the long-term success of your program and where you sit in terms of winning games this upcoming year to help maybe begin to change minds in the recruiting world so that you're not always constantly looking at the transfer portal as a savior. It can be used as such, and right now they're doing a great job. I think, big picture, I'll just say this, and I'll go over the names and we'll talk about what they did bring in, Tom. But for me, what I'm seeing is a group that understands you can raise the floor by bringing in average to pretty good football players who have already established themselves in Power 5 conferences. They've got film that you can watch, that you can see, and you can relate it to your current roster and what you have coming back. And you can say, we don't have a defensive end that gets after the passer that makes me feel good about doing something to remedy our damn sorry set of circumstances at defensive end. So let's bring in Jermaine Johnson. Check. They get him. Keir Thomas, kid comes in from South Carolina. Yeah, you see the three sacks and you say, okay, but it's more about his versatility. He's had success in the SEC. He's a pretty good football player. You can slide him inside on passing downs as well. So he's a guy that you feel pretty good about. He'll add to your depth. He's a better player than what you have. So at this point, Florida State improves themselves. Are they getting elite players? Are these kids that come in and immediately dominate? Well, in the case of McKenzie Milton, maybe. Maybe that's a drastic upgrade at quarterback. We'll have to see how he works in this offense. We'll have to see how healthy he is, what he still has left. I mean, that was a devastating leg injury. So in terms of being a runner, we really don't know what he has left. That was a gruesome injury. But we know he's a better thrower than anybody on the roster that Florida State has. And then from there, you know, you look at a Jamie Robinson. He's a safety that comes in out of South Carolina. He was an average player at South Carolina, an average safety in the SEC. They have some talent as Florida State at the position, but I do think that you add some depth and experience depth at that. That's important. You get that. You bring in a running back from Auburn who, you know, I kind of surprised that they brought in, not because he can't play, he can, but rather because I thought they actually, that's one of the positions I thought maybe you don't need to go get anybody.
The good news there, though, is he's young and early in his career. Not all these guys have 1 year of eligibility left.
That is correct.
It's like grabbing a bona fide high school recruit, you know, because, again, last year didn't count against your eligibility.
That is right.
It's a free redshirt year for everybody. So, you know, if you're not going to leave early, which I don't think most of these guys that we go get, if they're in their underclassmen portion of their careers, they ain't leaving early. Because they're leaving wherever they are to come to Florida State. We're not that place anymore. hopefully we get back to being there soon.
That's correct.
But that's where, you know, if you look at the transfer portal, it's not the same thing as the graduate transfer market. Don't confuse those two things.
That's right.
These guys have multiple years. A lot of them do.
Well, and DJ Williams is a guy that, speaking of multiple years, you go back a couple of years to his freshman season and you see the talent. You see what he's capable of. This is a kid who, when you're just looking at highlights, trying to figure out what he is as a running back, is he a game changer? No, he's not that. Is he a thick, hard-nosed runner that provides a little something that maybe you don't have in that running back group right now? He is, and he's capable of having good games against good teams. Had a great game against LSU. He's a player that you think, okay, you know, you bring in, he upgrades the position group. It'll be interesting to see how he fits. He comes in. He was a three-star kid coming out of high school. He arrives now and elevates your running back room. I think there's no doubt, Tom, we didn't bring it up, but because at the time that it happened, we talked about it. But now, fast forward to where we are now, getting Andrew Parchment, it was a big deal at wide receiver because that was an area that was, sorely lacking, to say the least. Wide receiving core has been pretty poor, and he's a kid that you pencil in now or you perhaps in pen, you put him in as a starter day one.
Well, now he is a one-year player on the other hand, yes. And you're going to get the most out of him. I don't know if that means production-wise. I'm just saying targets. He's going to see a lot of them because the competition is not much there at that position. So that was huge to get a player like that.
You go back to the Arkansas corner, Jarquez McClellan. You get him in, and he's a guy that again I think is an average player. I don't think he's an elite player. I think he gives you added depth at the corner position where you could use it. I will be very curious to see a couple of things. Yes, Florida State was able to get Devontae Love Taylor to say he's coming back. He did provide a boost this past year. There is no question about that. That's helpful. Florida State needs to add more offensive linemen to this, and I mean linemen that can help them right now. So maybe after spring, one is available that they like, and you could bring him in. That's, knock on wood, my hope for now. But, of course, I didn't mention Mackenzie Milton and this list of people that they've brought in the transfer portal. That perhaps was, without question, the biggest upgrade that you saw because he has been an uber-productive player at the highest level at the most important position. Florida State's a better team with what Mike Norvell and his staff have done with the transfer portal. There's no getting around that. Knock on wood, everybody stays healthy and makes it through spring and all of that. These are guys that come in and help right now. And as you begin to build not only a depth of roster and talent, and you change the culture, you got to get guys that you can bring in that bridge the gap immediately. I think all these guys do that to varying degrees, obviously. Some far more impactful than others. Mackenzie Milton will probably have the biggest impact. From there, I would say Jermaine Johnson, next on the list of guys that have the next biggest impact. He's a guy that can he's a bona fide pass rusher.
Well, between him and Thomas, yeah, I mean, you're doing a lot there on all downs. Because Johnson, he wants more snaps. The reason he's here is because he demanded more snaps. Georgia wasn't going to give them to him, and we will. if you want to play, we got some time for you.
Get ready for 60 snaps a game,
and
pal.
Then with Thomas, he can be somebody who sets the edge like a Kando did for us, or Janarius at times when he played well. He could be somebody who sets the edge for you on first and second down, and then you can flex him inside to play in the interior for third and obvious because he also played end, and he just grew out of his – a natural end body.
Love his body type. When you look at him, he fills out a uniform. He's a big, strong dude that's had success in the SEC. You feel good about his chance to come in and help you right away. All right, we'll go back to this. I want to talk to Ira about it. I know he wrote an article for warchant.com. We'll look back at Florida State. By the way, all is a go for Florida State basketball. That's the other piece of really big news that transpired over the weekend. Heard from Coach Hamilton. They're all a go. They've been practicing. They're ready to get it on. They're going to play three games in a pretty short stretch. So it will be taxing. Lord knows they're rested. It's time to get it on and get back to playing basketball and figuring out what this team can be. Right now, they've got a lot of work ahead of them, defensively especially. So they need to get back on the court.
It'll be interesting to see the fruits of that labor and see what way they want it to go. If they do use multiple looks at different parts of the game, if certain rotations have certain elements to the way they play, if they switch 1 through 5, if they go small, but not if they play big. I mean, all these things are going to be fun to find out over the next three games, but it's NC State here. Thankfully, coming out of the break, it's a home game. So you play NC State Wednesday, North Carolina Saturday, and the quick turnaround to Louisville on Monday night.
It is a real quick turnaround, but you know what? I'm just going to be happy, and I'm not going to take it for granted. I'm going to watch basketball. I'm going to see this team trying to get better. They're going to be a much better team at the end of the season, so long as this season gets played to its entirety. than they are right now. We know that. They have some working pieces. They have some wins that you feel good about. They have a couple of losses that raise an eyebrow. So that's where we sit right now. Now, in terms of the NFL games over the weekend, we didn't get the number of quality games that I was hoping for. We got a couple of really good games. The rest were kind of, you know, there may not have been anything more boring than watching Saints-Bears yesterday. That was, Jesus. Two offenses that were not very good, two defenses that are very good, in a game that you thought the Bears, well, they could have played for 14 quarters, 16 quarters, 18 quarters, and they were not going to score more than the nine they did. They were lucky to score the nine, the last one coming on an unbelievable catch on the last play of the game.
Yeah, you had the trick play drop, and that was it. I actually watched it on Nickelodeon because I was looking for something different. Just give me a different approach.
Yeah, I mean, and
I was half paying attention to it, but it was better, I'm sure, than the CBS feed, because if you were trying to seriously break that game down and act enthusiastic as you were doing so, I don't know. That would be an exercise in fiction, probably.
The narrative, as the kids like to say today, for the weekend's games would be the demise of the Pittsburgh dynasty, and it is done. That is that. That was a bad version of Ben Roethlisberger. It was the same version we saw really over the last four or five games where he was not very good. They've got some decisions to make. Not being able to run the ball effectively the last couple of years has turned out to be a bit of a problem for them. Meanwhile, the other part of that narrative is that Lamar Jackson gets a win in Baltimore for his first ever playoff win. Baker Mayfield getting one in Cleveland. He played well, I might add. So interesting as we watch these games play out. Of course, the Bucs get their first playoff appearance in 13 years, their first playoff victory in 18 years, and it was all Tom Brady, really, because this was not a great effort by the defense going against a 15th-string quarterback who had the night of his life.
Yeah, the funny thing is, during the course of the season, if you were a casual NFL fan, you're probably like, oh, Brady's the one who's getting it all done for Tampa. And week to week, really, how many games did he play where he was A-level in the regular season? Maybe like two or three, maybe?
I'd probably say a few more than that. I mean, the last four, he was great because of who they played.
Right.
So he put up huge numbers in those
opponent
games.
Adjusted. Yeah, but like in that first half of the year, the defense was exceptional, and there were times where Ronald Jones was a big reason they won. This was all Tom. I mean, if you were that casual NFL fan, you would be right about the performance on Saturday. My God.
I think you're watching that game and you're saying, man, this guy is going to throw for a lot more in terms of yardage and efficiency and everything else that you're going to have against that defense on the road in a playoff game. And one of his best receivers, the most reliable receiver he has, Chris Godwin, is just going to decide to drop everything thrown his way. That's doing some things. That's carrying your team to victory. It really was stunning. I think defensively, that's the concern Bucs fans have moving forward, and they should be, because watching a kid named Heinicke that nobody had ever heard of look like Fran Tarkenton is rather frustrating. But you know, it could very well be. You don't have film. You don't have a lot going for you there in terms of what doesn't he like to do. What are his tendencies? Can you force him to his offhand, whatever it might be? But it was really, really frustrating.
Yeah, so the obvious thing about the Bucs now, if you haven't watched them a bunch and now you're really tuning in for the playoffs and you kind of ignore when we talk about the Bucs, they can do two things. Number one, they can play a soft-ass defense and look terrible.
Jesus, can't
Number
they?
Two, if they're in a rhythm with pressures, they can get home and change the course of a game, and they can overwhelm an opponent to the tune of 21 to 28 points in the span of about 10 football minutes. The problem is, the second of the two identities, we haven't seen it in quite a while against a good opponent.
Yeah, they don't get home. They haven't consistently gotten home time and again to where they overrun people, overwhelm people. You know, they haven't done it in the second half of the season. They did it when Vita Vea was there. And they did it a little bit after, but not much.
Yeah, the Carolina game is about the last example of it.
Yeah, really frustrating. Let's go back to Lamar Jackson, who I love watching guys who are on the precipice of a disaster find a way to reach down and make a play, and then to think back and reflect back on that, knowing, and he can't know it in the moment, of course, but we can as fans and observers and analysts, right? We can say, wow, in retrospect, that play will change the way he's talked about and viewed. Fairly or unfairly. And that play happened after they had gone three consecutive three and outs and are down 10-0. And here we sit, it's 3rd and 7. And he's forced out of the pocket. He has to roll right. And he throws a laser just before going out of bounds to Mark Andrews. And it's a 17-yard catch. It's a first down. That drive later on turns into 3 points. Settles them down. It's 10-3. From there, he has the big run. We all know the 48-yard run for a touchdown against the man look, and he finds a lane, takes off and just makes everybody look silly, as he's prone to do with his legs, and he has a great day on the ground, rushing for 136 yards and a touchdown on 16 carries. He was okay in the air. That's kind of who he is as a passer. 17 of 24, 179 yards, had a really ugly pick to help get them down 10-0. But that said, that play on 3rd and 7 that sustains that drive and keeps their defense off the field, who had been out there for 10 minutes already of the first quarter, changed the tide of the game, shifted what that game could become. Now, their defense had shown up. Baltimore's defense was there shutting down Derrick Henry. They made it known early and often they were going to be there all day long, but they would have gotten worn out on another couple of 3 and outs. This would have been the 3rd straight, as I said, and they had already been out there for 10 minutes of the first quarter. That was a big damn deal.
It's an interesting team, Baltimore, because if they had the left side of their offensive line still,
they would be really, really dangerous.
I think they're still limited, but that throw, there's no doubt, that's the better of the two plays. Like, of course, the long run's going to get the run because of how fast he is, and he is the blur of all blurs. But when he's letting go of the football, the camera doesn't have the receiver. You can't see what's going on down the field. So it's a perfect example to freeze it and say, all right, what are the chances this is going to be a successful play for Baltimore? 1 in 100? 1 in 1,000? Because that's what it felt like. And then the next thing you know, he makes the catch. They're incredulous on the broadcast because they don't know if Andrews comes down with the catch. He did.
Yeah.
And you're right. It was like the long touchdown run was also a broken play. But even before he makes that one throw, you could see the body language. Everything about it was, all right, nothing is effed here, man.
Yeah, we're going to be okay.
We're stopping Derrick Henry. As long as I can get us to the 20s, I think we're going to be all right. And that's what they did.
Buffalo ends a long, long drought with their victory, 25 years in the making, as they say. And that game turned out to be a little bit more thrilling, perhaps, for Buffalo fans than they would have liked. 27-24 over Indianapolis. The Colts are an interesting team moving forward, if I start with them. They've got a lot of pieces. They got a lot of things that they can hang their hat on. A quarterback's not really one of them right now. You got to move on from Phillip Rivers, I would think. And it would be interesting to see whom they elect to go to in free agency, if that's the route they want to go. There's some candidates out there that I think fit them nicely. Or do they draft a quarterback? Certainly, Phillip Rivers is not the long-term answer. He had his moments in this game like he often does where he looks good. The competitor in him is always on display. I admire that. He's going to fight. He's red ass. He's angry Phillip Rivers. He's all those things. He's also not great anymore. So they've got to make the decision. Something similar is going on in Pittsburgh. Roethlisberger, as a franchise quarterback, nothing short of a roaring success in his time in Pittsburgh, a Hall of Famer to be without question, numbers that will stand the test of time for him in Pittsburgh. He's also looking like he is completely shot and incapable of being the guy he once was. They, too, have to think about moving on. The Titans are interesting. Are on the wrong end of this game that we're talking about with the Bills. The Ravens. I am kind of curious what they become moving forward because their defense is the bigger problem there right now. I'm okay with Tannehill. He's played well for the most part. They've got Derrick Henry, 2-time rushing leader in the league. He didn't play well in this game, got shut down. Body language wasn't good, but he's an elite player. We know that. They got an elite receiver as well. They're going to be interesting to see what they do defensively.
That was such a weird game. I mean, like, I know that the obvious answer would be Pittsburgh-Cleveland is the weird game against expectations of the weekend.
That's 28-0 in the first quarter.
You look at the pace of the way that game was played. If you tell a Tennessee fan that Baltimore is scoring 20 points and that's it in this game, you know, they would take it before the game kicked off and they think they win by 8 points, 10 points, maybe
something
2 scores.
Along those lines, yeah.
And yet, just the flow of the way that thing looked, for Mike Vrabel to punt the ball when he's on the plus side of the 50-yard line in a game where you know you don't have possessions. Points count for a lot. This isn't your 38-35 Titans game in the last month.
Well, there were a couple of them, and you saw what Tomlin did.
Tomlin did it. But then also, what an asinine 4th and goal from the 6 from Indy in the first half. I mean, it's the second quarter.
I know.
What are you, 4 from the 6? If it's from the half-yard line, I get it. But usually the barometer, right, if you're running on offense, is if we get past the 5 or to the 5-yard line, we can operate on offense a little bit. We have breathing room. So even if you like, if you get stopped in 4th and goal from the 1, you understand the benefit to your defense. From the six, and
yeah,
then Blankenship hits it off the upright. I mean, that game was there for Indy to win.
It was, and I thought for a short, very short period of time they were going to, and I was kind of getting heartbroken for the fine folks in Buffalo who were there as a coronation. Right? I mean, Josh Allen played well, as he has all year long. It was a weird game.
But in a weekend where there's going to be a lot of critical talk about coaches, I think Frank Reich, because they played in that first game, he gets spared a little bit Otherwise, I would bring that up at the top of the list. Fourth and goal from the six. What are you doing?
One of the reasons that he will not receive a ton of blowback for that, and you're right, is that he's done a remarkable job. I mean, everything else about what he has done to get to that point of making that poor decision has been largely well-received, well-thought-of, and understandably analyzed in a positive way. He's done a good job with them. And he's a smart guy. It's just been it was strange. I mean, nobody's immune.
Well, it ends up being a 3-point game at the end. You're like, oh man, yeah. You got to be kidding.
Well, look at our head coach who every week decides to do something crazy. Because if you just kick the extra point there on the second touchdown, you're up by 9 late in the game, and they're mathematically out of it.
Right. Yeah, it's going to be one hell of a battle between Bruce Arians' situational management and Sean Payton's ego from getting in his own way, calling plays for Taysom Hill when they're moving the ball just fine. What happens? A short field. Again, we talked about this on Friday.
Yeah, we did.
That was the toss pass against
Minnesota.
It was
kind of fun to talk about it and then watch it play out that way. Next up, Tampa Bay, New Orleans, and get ready to punch yourself you know where as you listen to all of the talk about Brady Breeze, Brady Breeze, Brady Breeze. And it matters, and it's great, and it's historical, and I'll take it in, and I appreciate both individuals greatly as a football fan. But, man, they won't give this a rest. This is going to be – you're just going to kind of hear a lot of sighs as you get, you know, you turn on SportsCenter. Oh, what do we, oh, okay, we're doing that. We're doing that here for 20 minutes. This is what we're going to do. Okay, click. That's what's going to happen. Tonight, the national championship takes place between Alabama and Ohio State. Go figure. I never thought Alabama would be here. Shocking to see these two teams in a national championship game again. But it is a good matchup. It is a great game. There's plenty of NFL talent out there for Ohio State. That's a good thing because they're going against one of the most prolific offenses college football has ever seen. Never thought I'd be able to say that a year removed from saying that exact same thing about LSU's offense, which was fair. But this one, from the numbers standpoint, matches up in efficiency pretty much exactly the same.
So the fun part about this game is it can look two different ways and explosive in either way, which is it could be Najee Harris versus Trey Sermon, which is so much fun to watch because those guys are so physical and they're dynamic. Or it could just be Fields versus Mac Jones in the receiving core at Alabama. Both ways it could work. I'm of the mind, I hope, like I said last week and like you just alluded to, I hope it's like Alabama-Georgia in 2012 in the SEC title game where it's one running back against
back
another.
Back and forth, back
physically
and forth.
Imposing their will, you know, 6 and 7 yards at a time. I'd love to see that because Sermon's so much fun to watch and so is Harris. But you could have the fireworks down the field.
I'm going to do the same thing I've done as I was prepping this morning, just noting numbers, kind of taking a step back each time I read one that wowed me. I'll do one here. I'll do some more in a bit. Alabama has scored on less than 50% of their possessions only once all year. They went 6 of 13 on their possessions against Mississippi State. That's the only time they were under 50%.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. And, oh, by the way, in that game, they were 5 of 7 points scored in the first half and then just cruised to victory. They were up 27-0. They were the halftime monsters that they always are.
You can throw that out then. Right. It's 50% or better than 50% when they care.
Oh, here you go. To give you specifics, against the three best defenses they've played, Georgia ranks first in defensive S&P+, Texas A&M ranks 14th S&P+, Notre Dame ranks 20th S&P+. All right, but just still, I mean, Notre Dame's a good defense, not an elite defense, but a good defense. Those are the three best, according to S&P+. In 33 drives against those units in those three games, Alabama scored 19 times and they averaged 41 points a game. That's ridiculous. And they may get their best receiver back tonight who didn't win the Heisman.
Even if he's a decoy, that's really valuable.
Pretty crazy. Jeff Cameron Show. Good Monday. Taiwan Malone was here over the weekend and took in the sights, the sounds, what there is for now. And
pay him. Yeah. Pay that man his money.
Well, here's the problem. Okay, so I last week talked about my legacy as somebody who's able to bring in defensive tackles for Florida State football over the years at a rate seldom seen anywhere. I'm a bit like Nick Saban when it comes to bringing in defensive tackles for Florida State. I get them one after the other. Once I lock my sights in on a guy and I proclaim him to the Noles, it pretty much happens. You can go back an awful long ways. It's a long list from Timmy Jernigan all the way to Goldman. Naughty to the Noles is famous, of course.
Marvin Wilson
I did out of Houston. So I was getting a bit of a gut feeling about Taiwan Malone. I thought, all right, I feel pretty good about this guy. I know that he's big time when it comes to baseball. He's looking closely. Really, the only chance we have is because he's looking big time at baseball. And that really kind of informs his list of teams. They have to be good at baseball as well as football. And the problem is we're facing two programs, Texas A&M being one of them, that, I don't think are afraid to do what it takes to win a recruitment battle, Tom. I don't think that there's any shortage of know-how.
Pay him. Pay that man his money.
But I can tell you, and I want to double-check on the exact wording, that, they feel good about how things went. I know that the one of those schools is a bigger problem than another, the other being Ole Miss.
Pay him. Pay that man his money.
So, it's not like you're going up against two programs that wouldn't do what was necessary to get the services of Mr. Malone, right?
I just believe every program should do what's necessary at this point. Especially one that's looking to get back into the conversation.
I was going to say, I care more about whether or not we do what's necessary at this point.
I didn't say that. I didn't say anything about us. I just say every program in America mm-hmm. should do what's necessary. I'm not saying we should. Necessarily,
fluffy. Fluffy.
Oh, the Bisquicks? Bisquick,
yeah.
We'll go from the KGB over to the other.
Yeah. Fluffy Bisquick pancakes.
That does need to happen. That is something that, you hold out hope for here that it's going to happen. But we'll see. We'll see. It was a positive visit. Good times.
Pancakes are so much better than duffel bags, Just an art to it.
Do you think we are watching a close game tonight in the fourth quarter?
Yes. Do you?
By close?
One score.
One score. Game in the fourth. Hot damn. I like it.
I don't know that we're going to see a lot of stops, and that's why it might be a close game.
Well, I'm holding out hope, probably hoping against hope, that, the fields we saw in the game against Clemson, which was extraordinary. I one of the best college football performances that we've seen in a long, long time in a game that was of that magnitude to show up that big and to do so while you're hurt is absolutely huge. I'm with you. I think it's a score fest tonight. By score fest, both teams are getting into the 30s. I believe that without question. There's a part of me that feels like you got to get to 40 if you want to win if you're Ohio State. I feel like you got to get to 40.
Oh, I think both coaches have to plan for that. And if it turns out that you didn't need it, fine. But, yeah, I think that's got to be the understanding here, is that you're calling the game aggressively earlier on to that end. So if it's 4th and 2 from the 40-yard line on the other side of the 50, you don't punt the ball like a lot of NFL coaches did this weekend. You keep going. You've got to keep the button down the whole time. Got to mash it all the way to 40, 45 points.
Najee Harris, over 110.5 yards rushing. Yay or nay?
Yes.
You get him at minus 115. Justin Fields, first to score a touchdown at 11-1, if you want it.
Does that – he could pass it, right? Or does that mean rushing touchdown for Justin Fields?
I think it has to be a rushing touchdown.
Oh, well, okay, maybe.
Olave, over 95.5 yards receiving.
Oh, that better be way over if Ohio State's going to win.
Only game he didn't amass that number of 100 yards or more was one game this year against Rutgers. They were up 42-9.5. He sat out.
Yeah, I mean, he'd have to be around a buck 50 plus if they're going to win this game.
First half over for points total, 38. You going over?
Yeah. Yeah. You?
I think so. Yeah. Alabama's so good.
You're always worried about the starts, the sloppy starts for a couple of drives.
Sloppy starts,
you know,
nerves,
8 minutes to go in the quarter and it's 3-0.
Yeah. I have some more of these. We can go over here in a minute. I know we went long in that first segment, but those are all good ones.
It's just weird though, right? I mean, like, I don't know if it has to do with the COVID thing, like you've been talking about, and the lack of legitimacy to this year's college football playoff, but it feels like the band that plays after the headliner. You know, it's like you're getting in the parking lot and you're leaving. You're like, oh, this other band's playing. The college football playoff typically is the highlight of the 3-day sequence that goes wild card Saturday, wild card Sunday, and then the college football playoff national championship. In this case, it feels like an afterthought, quite literally.
It was not surprising for me to see others echo that sentiment. I have been feeling this way for a while. I wish I didn't. I'm not trying to be a sourpuss nor a quote-unquote hater, but college football has a problem. And you know, when you are looking at these two teams, you're not surprised to see these two teams in it. It was either going to be Alabama and Ohio State or Alabama and Clemson. There really were no options going back however many weeks that you realize this. You know, that's problematic. Nobody thought Notre Dame would be competitive, and they weren't. You know, we do this every year. And I think they need to really address the lack of competitive balance in college football. I'm not saying that you put shackles on Ohio State or that you don't allow Alabama to dominate. They're doing what they have to do to dominate, and they are coached by an all-time legend who is a recruiting monster as well as good at X's and O's as you can find. So they're going to win. They're going to win. But you do have to find a way to have more people invested for longer periods of time. I feel like the college football season was largely over halfway through. I also think that this was obviously not through the fault of the NCAA or college football per se, but this was such an irregular season that it was hard to ever really get into any kind of feel for what was transpiring. You know, 1 week a team would play, then they would be off for 2 weeks, or 1 week a team would be at full strength, the next they would be missing 8 starters. You know, you had a lot of weird things that helped contribute to this feeling of it being a secondary sport compared to what it normally is, which is at the forefront of all of our minds. I mean, listen, I'm very aware of where I do this show and what my passions are. College football in the South is huge, and it always has been for me too. It just hasn't felt that way this year for me. And I understand some of that is without question the pandemic.
But the crazy thing is, while Alabama is the favorite tonight, and Alabama should be the favorite tonight, this game could legitimately be electrifying.
Oh, that is the sincere hope. I mean, I think it's a distinct possibility. If Ohio State plays with the same energy and the same efficiency that they played with against Clemson, they're going to be there at the end of this game. This is going to be a one-possession game, and both teams will be sitting around 40 points in the fourth quarter, and we're going to be thinking, holy hell. Now, I'd like to see a modicum of defense. We rarely do anymore. I know the way the game is skewed, but I'd like to see it.
It's a 3-0-7 game, isn't it?
Oh, all night long, buddy. Both teams going to move the ball between the red zone, between the 20s, into the red zone. Can you keep them out of the end zone? How many times? How many times can you get a necessary stop so that in the fourth quarter you got the ball and it's 41 all or 42-35 or whatever, and you got a shot to win it? Yeah. Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. reading articles on the defenses that gave Alabama the most amount of trouble, and there aren't many that gave Alabama any trouble. It is all relative. But if you want to rein in big plays, Ohio State's defense has done a lot of that for the most part. They're seventh in the S&P Plus, second best amongst Alabama's opponents this year. They have a ton of NFL future draft picks on the defensive side of the ball. Kerry Coombs, the defensive coordinator, they have been more reactive than aggressive, Tom. They have been a bend-but-don't-break defense, a lot of cover three. So keep it in front of you. Give yourself a fighting chance in the red zone. I think that would work here. You're not gonna cover Bama's receivers in man.
No, you're not. But no. The question is, can they do enough to get Mac Jones off of his spot and force him to make plays?
Yes, correct.
You know, otherwise it's just a pre-snap read, and he is so good at that. Like, a lot of quarterbacks who are really good on prolific offenses, they get greedy. He's not. If you're going to give him something before the snap, there's only six in the box because you're so worried about the receivers, it's a handoff. If it's you're going to stack the box because Najee Harris is not going to beat you today,
okay,
and you've got Smith in one-on-one, it's a quick slant. And he doesn't care. He doesn't hold the ball too long. So if you can force him to make some of those mistakes, maybe that's the opening Ohio State needs.
Got to be a great feeling to be him, to line up under center or in shotgun either way, and just knowing that you've got the best offensive line in college football in front of you, and that, you know, if you do need to hold the ball, if you do need to pat the ball and let something develop for one of your dynamic wide receivers who are going to separate themselves if given enough time, that, that group up front is a freaking wall. I mean, he knows he's got plenty of time to make it happen. I think the most impressive thing about what we saw with Justin Fields attacking Clemson wasn't just that they had a clear plan to utilize their tight ends, which was fantastic, and he put it on them all night long. In any of those one-on-one matchups, he took advantage of that. They had to win those one-on-one matchups against a good Clemson personnel, and they did. But also, he bought time in the pocket, and he'll have to buy time in the pocket tonight. Conversely, we talk about Mac Jones, but you look at the other side. Justin Fields was as dynamic as he was, not this year, earlier in the season, but the year before when he was healthy and confident and playing consistently well. This year he was a bit up and down. You know, I heard something interesting this morning. This morning, if you missed it, Jimbo Fisher was on these airwaves, ESPN Tallahassee, during the Jay Will, Keyshawn, and Zubin show. But I thought Coach did a great job, as he always does. I mean, he's got a career once he's out of coaching. Coach Fisher can analyze a game and personnel as well as anybody if he just takes the time to slow down. When he does, he's really good. But he was talking about the kind of weapons that we talk about all the time with Alabama, right? And he was talking about why they're kind of impossible really to line up against because of what you just noted, which is if you try to take something away, they have the personnel and the ability to focus on all the other things that remain available. But you go back to Justin Fields, he gave himself those times, those moments to make big plays by moving within the pocket very subtly. His footwork was phenomenal. Got the ball down the field, showed real touch and strength. Everything we really hadn't seen from him in the 3 weeks prior to that game.
Yeah, he was able to deliver throws down the field without the traditional base underneath him because he was creating the space necessary to get the throw off.
And then with a flick of the wrist, 60 yards in the air.
But he's got a chance to do it better against – and I don't mean, you know, he's got more wow plays in him. I'm just saying I would think if you stack up what Clemson's front brings to the table consistently against Alabama's, they're all five stars. Everybody's five stars at these same three, four schools every year. I get that. He's got a chance to have more time to make these things work for Ohio State. I would think, though, the first move on the chessboard, if you're playing this like a game of chess, is Ohio State is going to test Alabama on the ground. Can they give some relief to Justin Fields, yeah, create more play-action RPO opportunities, and keep him upright and give him a better chance to come out of this game fully healthy by allowing Sermon to go to work? Because early, if they're able to run the ball and establish it early on, it's not necessarily about the old adages of football. You've got to establish
the
run.
Right, right. No. It's
no. You're preserving your quarterback, and you're also giving yourself more opportunities in the play action.
I want to see how healthy he is. We'll know early on. You know, how healthy is Justin Fields? I mean, he obviously played the rest of that game spectacularly. You can do it. But you know, he's had a little bit of time here. Let's see where he's at health-wise. And is he willing to run? Remember early in that game, and that's also what got him in trouble, he hurt Clemson bad with his legs. Anything that broke down, he had an opportunity to pick up positive yardage and set them up at second and short, third and short. After that, he wasn't going to run as much, as we well know, but he was able to buy time, but also was given a lot of time, made all the throws necessary. I think tonight for them to win, to have a chance to win late, they've got to make Alabama move methodically. It's got to be a bunch of long drives. Bama can do that, but it has to be, you know, you hold them to some field goals in the red zone there. And then secondarily, I think he has to be a runner on offense as well. He's a great passer, but I'd like to see him obviously make some plays on the ground as well.
This is where college football is broken to me, and I will be a broken record about the clock needing to run more in the game.
The game will go on for days.
Well, and this one might, and that's fine. It's the last one of the year, and we got here. You know, I know it's a regular, but it's a celebration of the sport that it was able to persevere through all this, and it seems like, knock on wood, they've avoided real disaster and tragedy within, you know, the rosters and the coaching staffs. But Alabama can go seven plays and, you know, 70 yards, which is explosive, but they can do so in like 52 seconds because mm-hmm. they just race up to the line. I mean, imagine telling an Alabama fan or a college football fan back in 2012 that this is what Alabama's offense would look like.
I thought about that throughout the course of the year, thinking to myself, man, between what they had with Tua, and remember, the year he got hurt, he was cruising to a Heisman, and he was putting up massive numbers. Now we're seeing that pretty consistently from Alabama, which was the one thing that gave everybody hope previous to this run of good quarterback play, was that, okay, well, they're always going to have an average quarterback, an elite offensive line, an awesome running back or two, great receivers, dominant defense, but they'll be pretty pedestrian at quarterback. Well, they haven't been pedestrian at quarterback for some time, and that's frustrating because that was the final piece to the puzzle, right? And that's why you see an offense now that, again, from the offensive rankings over the last 20 years, efficiency rankings, only LSU is better than this one, and it's barely better. That's ridiculous.
And that's with Waddle being hurt early in the season.
But not before they played Texas A&M and put a number on them, and Jimbo will point that out to you every time he gets a chance. Well, we had to play with Waddle. Nobody else did. Douse!
It was to our detriment. Waddle being on the field is not good for defenses.
It's not good for defenses, to say the least. Oh, man. Ira Shafel, warchant.com, going to join us to start the next hour. Stay with us. Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. 2, Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. Good to be with you. Hope you're well on this Monday. A lot to catch up with, get to, all that stuff as we continue online, ESPNTallahassee.com. There you go to listen live via the streaming if you want. You can always just listen on the old-timey radio. You can email us if you like, JCS@97.ESPNRadio.com. Find me on Twitter at Jay Cameron Show. Of course, we're also on YouTube. Lots of ways. After the show, the entire 3 hours get posted to Apple Podcasts, anywhere else you get podcasts. God, I can speak, can I? Let's hope I can as I head to the Phone Hero Hotline for our guest, Ira Shafel, warchant.com. Hello, Ira. How the heck are you, buddy?
I'm good, Jeff. How you doing, man?
Well, I'm better, man. I feel like we should start with the story of the day, which really was the story of the weekend and continues to be the story of the offseason. And that is Florida State's continued effort to raise the floor and upgrade this roster through the transfer portal. And I know you wrote a piece for warchant.com. People can kind of get caught up, you know, maybe one by one, look through the pieces that have been added to this roster. It begins certainly with Mackenzie Milton coming in from UCF and all that he was able to do there as a three-year starter. But people may not be as familiar with the other names like Jermaine Johnson and Jamie Robinson and Kerr Thomas and others. So I would point them to warchant.com to read your piece. What do you make of what we're seeing here? I think the strangest thing that I've seen, I say strangest, I guess the only one that I look at and think, huh, that's interesting, was the DJ Williams get. Nothing wrong with that. Improving depth. Certainly he's a physical presence when you see him play at Auburn. He gives them something that they don't have necessarily. But when you do that, you take away maybe from being able to add elsewhere. So your thoughts on what they've done so far?
Yeah, I think it's they've done a really good job. And I think it's really different from last year. And that was kind of one of the things I was trying to make. The points I was trying to make with that story today was that, you know, if you look at them one by one, you know, I think some people look back and you can say, okay, well, you signed eight guys last year as transfers as well, but what did you get from it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, did that really change their season? Well, no, obviously it didn't because you went 3-6. So now you've gone out and signed seven transfers. You expect to maybe get one more, maybe even two more. So what is that going to do for you? And I think the difference from a macro level is that most of those guys weren't signed to be difference makers in 2020. I think, you know, last year, a lot of those guys were, you know, there were a couple of them that were expected to be impact players. Jayshon Corbin at running back, Devontae Love Taylor at offensive line. But I think for the most part, a lot of those guys were, hey, we've got some space available. We've got some scholarships to fill. Let's go see what's out there. Maybe there's some guys that can give us depth and give us guys that can contribute either this year or next. And that's what, you know, I think you see in Fabian Lovett and Darian Jones, the guys they brought from Mississippi State. Neither one of those guys were expected to be impact players in 2020. You probably got more out of Fabian Lovett than you expected because you didn't get much out of your returning defensive tackles, but that wasn't a big area of need. You know, you went out and got a couple of defensive ends, but you didn't know that was a huge area of need. And it turned out, you know, it would have been nice if they could have been more productive. But I don't know that when you signed Deontay Williams out of Baylor, that you thought he was going to beat out Josh Pinto, or that Jarrett Jackson was going to beat out Janoris Robinson. And so it was a lot of kind of guys that were to provide depth or maybe help out. Probably one guy that you expected to be a starter, and it didn't happen, was the tight end, Jordan Wilson, the kid from UCLA. You thought he'd be a blocking tight end. He ended up having a season-ending injury. Miko Dotson, another guy in the secondary that you hoped maybe would be more of an impact, but he was injured for most of the year, only played in a few games. So the difference with this group is, of the seven guys that they've got coming as transfers, I would guess six of them might end up starting. And if they don't, it'll either be a disappointment or somebody else really stepped up their game. Really the only one I would say you go into the year not really expecting him to be a starter or at least really competing, being a serious contender for starting, would be that running back, DJ Williams, who you mentioned. But I think that's the one that really is about depth. I mean, if he helps you win a game, great. But I really think that was more of a case of you need five scholarship running backs, and they only had four.
I would think that most of the fan base listening to us have this conversation now and maybe perhaps reading the article on warchant.com over the weekend or today would say to themselves, okay, well, this is good, But where are the tackles? Where are the offensive tackles? Can you talk to me about offensive tackles? Where the hell are the offensive linemen? They're just going to say that over and over and over again. And I would join them. I would echo that sentiment. Do you know if that's something we're just going to have to wait until after spring, that they expect some guys to enter the portal then, and they'll pounce on those when they get the opportunity? Perhaps there's a guy that they know is going to enter at some point, and they don't want to take a guy just to take a guy, but they think they've got a line on somebody. I mean, I know that this staff does not talk about kids if they haven't entered the portal or anything like that, even if they've maybe got a lead. That makes sense not to do so. Just what are you hearing about offensive linemen?
Yeah, I think that there. I don't think the need is quite as desperate as I think some people think. I mean, I think people, some people, you know, one of the responses to when I put up my article this morning was, we need two offensive tackles. But I don't think they're going to sign two offensive tackles. You know, I think if you look at what they have in Devontae Love Taylor, Robert Scott, some of the guys that they have that I think that they either feel pretty good about, I think there's continued development going to be there. I don't think they felt like that's a position where they needed to go out and get two guys. And on top of that, it's been a really thin market at offensive tackle on the transfer market. That's the one position where there really just hasn't been a lot of great guys out there. So to your point about, you know, do you want to just sign somebody just to sign somebody? I think because they've got somewhat limited numbers, I think they didn't push hard in a couple of the guys that had been out there. There were a couple guys out there that they kicked the tires on, and either they didn't push hard or the player went in a different direction. But I don't get the impression that they felt like they missed out on anything. So my guess is, as this process continues, maybe especially as you go through the spring, I think they'd still like to maybe land an offensive tackle if they can. So maybe they'll leave a spot open for that. But I don't feel like, you know, because of what's in the market, I just don't feel like that was an area where they could make a big splash. And I do feel like they feel like they've got some developing pieces to work with at offensive tackle, especially, you know, Devontae Love Taylor coming back.
Yeah, that was a big thing for Devontae Love Taylor to come back. And I know, like, Darius Washington and other guys like that, I think they could certainly use a tackle if they can find one. And maybe they'll get one in the spring, so we'll see if they leave a spot open there. But you're right, from everything I read and everything I could find, it wasn't a lot of really talented tackles out there that Florida State could bring in and get that would immediately upgrade them. I do feel like, measuring against the roster that Florida State has, when you look at the players they brought in, whether it's Jamie Robinson, whether it's any of the other guys, the aforementioned guys, I do feel like Florida State has immediately improved and raised their floor. I think you now got guys, may not be dynamic, may not be the best players, but you're not in a position to get the best players. The best players, the creme de la creme are going to transfer to places like Ohio State or Alabama or Clemson or something like that. So can you get guys that have been productive in a big-time conference like the SEC, for example, and immediately upgrade your roster? The answer has to be a resounding yes. That's what the transfer portal has been for Florida State so far in this cycle. I think that's a fair assessment, don't you?
Yeah, 100%. And really in a couple of positions where, you know, I don't even know that they knew. I think for the most part, it was about positions of need and trying to get impact players. And I think you do that with Andrew Parchman at wide receiver.
Yep.
He's a guy that caught 65 passes 2 years ago. He could be your number one wide receiver. That's a big get because that position was grossly underperformed this past season. And there's nobody that you just look at on that roster who's played and say, okay, that's going to be the number one this year. So he fills a huge need. I think on defensive line, Jermaine Johnson.
Huge.
They haven't had a pass rush since Brian Burns left. Jermaine Johnson's the guy that got 5 sacks last year in limited action. Keir Thomas is a guy that has basically started for 3 years for South Carolina on the defensive line. And that's not a great program, but they've had good defensive lines. He's a guy that can clearly play and improve what Florida State has on the defensive line. Whether he ends up is a big end or is a tackle, I think he could do either one. In a couple other positions, you got guys that you didn't even necessarily know were a need, but I think you improved quarterback, and it's easy to kind of move past McKenzie Milton because, it's the oldest one. It happened, over a month ago. But I don't know that they went into this offseason thinking, okay, we absolutely have to get a transfer quarterback. Somebody that could be a day one starter. But then he shows up in the portal, and all of a sudden it's like, man, that change, that could change everything about this football team because of what he is as a passer, but then also what he is as a leader and a teammate and just somebody in the locker room. So so from that standpoint, I just think that you've improved yourself in a lot of different ways. And in the transfer portal, it can be a pain, and it's there's going to, especially as this one time automatic eligibility waiver goes through with the NCAA, it's supposed to happen, I think, this week. It's going to create a lot of headaches for a lot of coaches. But, man, for Florida State, for Mike Norvell to be able to get that kind of infusion of talent quickly was really important. And again, it was at all the positions they really need to hit: wide receiver, defensive end, defensive back. I mean, I think those are the places they really need to have some success, especially at safety with Jamie Robinson, as you mentioned. I mean, he's a tackling machine. He got 75 tackles last year at safety. You know, I just think that they've really done well in the positions that they needed to do well. Except, you know, I would say probably offensive tackle is the one that they haven't. And my guess is they'll still try to address that.
Yeah, I think they are going to try to address that. It would be a wise move at this point. Real quick, basketball update us. I know Coach Hamm spoke to the media today. Looks like they're a full go. We may finally get to see basketball again, Ira.
I know. And, you know, talking to some people around the program, they're as frustrated as anybody about having to be delayed the last couple weeks. But they have been able to practice the last few days, and they're still very excited about this team. They're still very excited about the potential for it. You know, I think that what they've had to remind themselves, and I think we have to remind ourselves, is that, you know, the team last year played its best basketball as the season went on. That's really been the case for every Leonard Hamilton team because they play those larger rotations. It sometimes takes a while for guys to fit into roles. But they're still very excited about what they've got. I mean, obviously they had a couple of stumbles losing at Clemson, although Clemson turned out to be a pretty nice basketball team, and then also losing at home to UCF. But I think it's nice now that I think this sets up a little nice. I was worried about them having to come back from being off and then have to go straight on the road to Pittsburgh on Saturday. With that game getting canceled, now they get to stay at home for a couple games. They get NC State at home on Wednesday night. It's not an easy win by any stretch, but I think that sets up better for them. Especially coming off of the layoff.
What do you think they do defensively, Ira? The last we saw from Leonard Hamilton was him voicing frustrations, kind of rarely seen, him talking about the need to make changes. He doesn't usually do that publicly. If he's thinking about it, he doesn't usually tell the media necessarily. I thought it was interesting that maybe this is a group that can't switch 1-5 the way that others have in the past. I think he's right, by the way. I think it would be a smart move. But what are your thoughts on that? What do you think they do?
I think they still switch a lot, but maybe not 1-5. You know, and I think that's where they just got into too many bad situations there, and they didn't have enough guys that could protect the rim. So I don't think it's going to be a drastic difference. I don't think they're going to go to where now they're fighting through every screen. And because one of the benefits to what they do by switching on the screens is it really takes away a lot of the action for these other teams' offenses. If you just go straight back to playing more of a traditional man-to-man defense, and you're trying to go under and over every screen, you're going to lose some of that advantage. So that's my guess, is they're going to try to maybe switch 1-3 or 1-4. But I'm excited to see it, man, and excited to see if it works, because you know, it really was disappointing to see the way they played in those couple of losses.
Yeah, I'm just excited to see him get back on the floor again. Always appreciate it, brother. Be well.
Thanks, Jeff. We'll see you.
All right, take care. That's Ira Shaffel, warchant.com. Good piece on these recruits. Come back, react to that in a moment. I do think that they actually – I think it is a more pressing need maybe than Ira does. I think they got to go find a tackle. They need another offensive lineman for sure. And I would like to see them do that. If you just look on passing downs, they were one of the worst pass-blocking offensive lines in the country. So if you're bringing in McKenzie Milton, and I don't know what he's going to be as a runner. So, you know, you had to have the service of Jordan Travis's legs to bail out your line in pass pro last year. And you did. And when he was there, you had a fighting chance. When he's not, if you're sitting there back there just trying to throw the football, I think you got real problems.
Yeah, I think that, you know, Love Taylor would be the insurance policy at tackle. Right. You don't want him to start at tackle because even this year they wanted to get him inside.
Yeah.
They did. They played him at guard. And they had the choice because he could have played in front of anybody else in the depth chart. But the question is, how much do they like Orr as an early participant, right? Because Robert Scott, by midseason, became our best answer at right tackle. Do they think that that's what Rod Orr is going to be at either right or left? because maybe that informs the discussion about the priority level on one tackle versus two. But I agree with you, at minimum one would be ideal.
They also think long-term Robert Scott's a guard. So, I mean, you know, it'll be interesting. They're moving things around and just doing what they can. That's why adding that depth and having a legitimate tackle who projects as a tackle, I think that's the route you got to go. Now you can move, mix and match, get your best five out there, guys that are versatile.
I believe every tackle we've had the last 5 years projects better at guard.
Because we don't – well, we had a tackle that projected as a tackle who, for whatever reason, I mean, just failed miserably and couldn't play. And it got weird because it was all mental after a while. It was a thing where
– the other one should have been kicked off a team and was.
Right. So you just – you really haven't been able to find tackles, Tom.
Everybody else, Dickerson, Scott, Darius Washington, Love Taylor.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, so you got to find one. Got to go out and get you a tackle. Ira is right. It wasn't teeming. The waters weren't teeming with tackles that you could just go pluck and bring in, and you don't want to bring in a guy to bring in a guy. I mean, try to find somebody that can play a little bit. That's what they've done here. I want to expand on this. We'll do it next. Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. Back real quick, and I know tonight's the national championship game, and you get to see two teams that are, I don't know, a canyon the size of the Grand Canyon, better than Florida State, whose rosters are about that size in terms of where we sit and where they sit. But things change quickly in college football, as we've seen before, and these two programs are the machines that just keep on keeping on. It's very impressive to get back to being capable of maybe being mentioned in the same breath or having an opportunity. You know, you got to walk before you can run. And Florida State's roster is, or was, at the end of last year, pretty poor. I think you saw that week to week. Like, we could get into what wasn't happening in terms of coordination on defense, and I still have a lot of questions about that moving forward. But there's no doubt they were lacking personnel. They haven't had a defensive end that was even decent since Brian Burns, and, you know, I had my problems with him, even though he was productive. And at the end of the day, you got to say he would have helped this team currently. You know, they don't have anybody that caliber. So I think that what you look at immediately is you do the thing that gives you the best chance to raise the floor and get to 500. Now, next year's schedule is difficult. I was going over it last night, and I do think you have a bunch of top 25 teams that you play next year. Let's put it that way, okay? And so we're not, yeah. Mm-mm. That's a toughie, Tom. But what I would tell you is you give yourself a fighting chance, certainly, if you can get to 500 and build some momentum, having properly, obviously, shifted the culture, get everybody pulling in the same direction. You see the upgrade. You see some of the proof of concept continue. I know that you've already seen some of that offensively. We're going to need to see some of it defensively because we've yet to see that, that's for sure.
That's where you have to really trust this coaching staff and the vetting process of existing players, that they've got enough connections in the conferences or at the universities that these players are coming from to say, hey, Mike, yes, that's correct. If you want to take this guy, I wish we could still keep him, but he's going to fall in line. He's going to do what you want him to do. Because right now the culture is so fragile and the attrition is so high that really, I mean, if you whiff on two or three dudes, that could undermine everything that he's trying to do.
Yeah. No, I, you know, listen, you're going to have building through the transfer portal is not ideal. It's just necessary right now. And you've seen it done successfully in some places. You've seen years where it's done successfully and then other years where it hasn't. It's a relatively new thing, so we don't have that big of a sample size. But there's no question that it had to be done here. None. You ran off a ton of players, and I think rightfully so. You either forced them to leave or presented a situation where they didn't want to stay. Either one, you were doing it to change the culture and to change what you could become long-term. And I think for Florida State, what we look at consistently is that this is all about the long-term. This is not something that next year we go win nine games. Florida State's not winning nine games next year. Now, I think one of the underrated aspects of a rebuild and in the current situation with this coaching staff that doesn't get talked about enough, and I bring it up as often as I can, partly maybe to remind myself, but also just to remind everybody who's impatient, because I'm impatient too, and it's tough to be patient when you're losing games. As I love to say, losses happen for a reason, and they elicit certain emotions when they happen, even if in the preseason you predict they're going to happen, right? It doesn't really matter. You know we're going to lose this game, and then you go lose that game. The plays that occur that lead to a loss piss you off. You know, you get mad about them, and you respond accordingly. But I think what we do not – I think lend enough credence to is where this staff got really screwed and it was completely unpredictable. They were already going to be behind the eight ball. Being a third coaching staff in 4 years is a ridiculous set of circumstances. But then COVID hits and you don't get a spring. You know, you don't get the opportunity to help change culture, to install. You don't even get a normal offseason. Like, prior to that, they didn't even have a normal offseason. Coach Storms couldn't do what he needed to do. He was well on his way. You saw the transformation in body type and attitude. But then that all got interrupted because of COVID, and kids went back home, and you had a situation where proper rehab couldn't be done, proper nutrition couldn't be done. I mean, imagine if I went back home to my parents' house, and they're of means. They couldn't feed me nearly as well as what you get here at a place like Florida State for athletic programs. So it's impossible to expect that a kid would come back in the same sort of shape, or that he would have done everything right on his own. And if he had an injury, he couldn't even utilize the facilities the way that you would want him to rehab and strengthen the area of need. So they didn't get to do any of that. And that's devastating. Then you talk about timing. You talk about 7-on-7 stuff and getting together on your own away from coaches. Now, we all know, wink, wink, nod, nod, how that works. I'm sure there's a game plan as handed down by the coaches, but they're not allowed to be there. But as long as you've got somebody you can trust who understands your offense, understands what you're asking them to do, that can go lead it the way Jameis would lead it when Jimbo wasn't around and, you know, all that stuff. Well, that's important. That's really important. They didn't get to do that either. Couldn't get together. Then you couldn't have a normal fall. You couldn't have the regular types of competition in practice that you would normally have for fear of getting guys hurt. You already were dancing on eggshells because of COVID. You really couldn't do two things. You couldn't afford to get guys hurt because you were being overly physical in practice. And number two, you couldn't afford to piss somebody off and have them decide, well, I don't want to be here. Not while you're trying to play a season and numbers are thinning as the weeks go by. So I really feel like they didn't get to do anything that a normal staff, upon arriving at a university, beginning the stages, the beginning stages of a flip, if you will, and changing, they didn't get to do any of that stuff.
So what percentage would you say this year would be? 60 or 70% of normal?
I think they're going to get mostly normal. I think that I would love it if they could push spring back.
Me too.
I would love that.
I'd love if the conference level, the commissioners would say, at each conference, not just the ACC. I'm not looking at Swaffy, who's a lame duck at this point. Like, everybody just say, you know, we've got rules on spring participation. We're going to relax those this year.
Yeah.
You got to be done by May 30th, June 1st, whatever.
Yeah, I'd love to push it back if it's at all possible. You want to get further away from where we are currently in order for inoculation to happen for more people. And for this thing to have a chance to be back to, you know, you just saw yesterday, I'm not making this political, I'm just pointing something out. Biden said within the first 100 days, a big point of emphasis is to ensure teachers and students are able to safely go back to school. He wants to push the vaccine and the inoculations to happen in mass as fast and in an organized fashion as can possibly be done. Well, that's important because I think that the sooner we can get everybody back on campuses, back in brick and mortar schools, back in, you know, and we're able to do that, then the sooner we can get normal with everything, every other facet of our life.
Yeah, the sooner that you can flip the lights on and there is not a call to do anything else other than flip the lights on and go live, the sooner that you can be back in Doak, the sooner that they can hold their practices the way they need to hold their practices, and the sooner that Mike and coaching staff, because they should allow the head coaches a little leeway this year.
Yeah.
They can get in their damn car and drive around the state and shake hands and talk to these coaches around the state and start to build those personal relationships that they're not allowed to right now. I mean, you're telling me that it was on Friday. You talked about it. Yeah. A two-sport athlete. Got a defensive lineman. He's 300 pounds. He wants to play baseball. You telling me he was just hanging out in Tallahassee all weekend?
Right.
Like, that's what he's supposed to do on his own dime, come and just take a look at the buildings? Okay. Yeah, right.
Now, I think, listen, you're pushing to get to something that resembles normal by May, and that's the goal. Now, they're way behind where they thought they'd be with the first 20 million vaccines coming in. They thought they would be able to administer those before the end of December. They administered 8 million. They're way behind, not even half of what their goal was. We'll see if they get better at it as we move forward. One would think that you get better at it the more you do it and the more that you learn from your mistakes. So we're going to follow that closely because it affects Florida State football. It affects
everything.
Of course it does, but I'm just going for the purposes of this show. It affects Florida State football. It affects everybody. But they're trying to sell tickets as if they're selling to a full house next year.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to plan universities across the country as if everything is a back full go.
I would be stunned if there aren't full houses next year. And I don't mean like, you know, Florida State sold every ticket because people are enthusiastic. I just mean like I would fully expect that all college football stadiums are allowed to be at 100% capacity.
Yeah, that's certainly you'd like to believe that by the time we roll around to next fall.
Because there will be a point where you go, well, what are we doing? Like in terms of if you have the options, what are we doing?
Oh, yeah, if you have the options.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, yeah. You got to get there. I'm not going to
present the options and then open the doors.
Yeah, it's correct. I'm not going to assume anything just yet. Let's make sure that all the options are on the table for everybody. You know, and if that happens, then, yeah, I'm with you there. But Florida State, back to the players they've brought in, the two most significant – well, the most significant area of need has been addressed, defensive end. Now, wide receiver was close to that list, and that, too, has been addressed with a number one coming in. But I don't want people to think what we just did was take our roster from being, you know, below average to good. It's not. It's a work in progress. They still got a ways to go. There's a reason you're able to get some of these kids Listen, not every one of these guys is going to come in here and shine. They're just not. The statistics tell you that. But I do think there's a good chance that the two guys at defensive end, and I would say that the Kerry Thomas kid can slide inside on passing down, so he's a guy you move in and out. That's nice. Versatile players matter when you don't have any. I would also point out Jermaine Johnson. That was a big get. That was a really big get. So those are the two I'm most excited about, not named Mackenzie Milton at quarterback. But you did a lot with just those three guys. We'll see what the others become, but just those three guys, and I know we got a lot more, I think seriously upgraded Florida State and made their floor certainly risen.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what the week-to-week existence of this team looks like when I'm talking about penalties, I'm talking about details, when they play, how bought in do they look, what's the attitude of the team, and how competitive are they? Like, you know, in some of these games, you're not going to – there's no chance. Clemson, you got no chance. Florida, you got maybe, but I wish that game was in September and not the week after Thanksgiving.
Yeah, early in the year,
so who the hell knows there.
Yeah.
Notre Dame, maybe you catch them a little early, but Kyron Williams in week one, that's a hell of a challenge. So in those games, are they afterthoughts by halftime, or are you still fighting? You know, are people around the country going, ooh, wait a minute, Florida State's in this one? That's what I'd love to see this year, is a few instances beyond the 50-50 games in ACC play that we already know, that against teams that are much better than us, are we coaching at a level that keeps us in games for a long period of time? And maybe these kids are going to be the cornerstones to that.
Biggest test is for Adam Fuller, who didn't do anything that shows me he is the answer. He might be. It's impossible to judge him in year one, given the circumstances. A lot of really unfortunate sets of circumstances for him to deal with. I also, having said that, didn't see anything that encouraged, made me feel real encouraged. This will be a show and prove year. I don't imagine that if we see what we just saw, that he's here after next year. It can't look anything close to that. That was an embarrassment.
Yeah, that's one of the talking points after week two or week three of the season was, it's hard, given all of the qualifiers on the season, to not feel confident in what you're doing as a coach, like as a fan or as an analyst looking and saying, I'm not confident in what they're doing. Like, because there are so many outs. You have all of these reasons that it might not work, and yet it still looked so fundamentally bad that the job approval rating tanks. That's hard to do.
Yeah, it didn't change. I don't think it tanked for Norvell. I don't think it tanked for Atkins.
No, for Fuller.
Just Fuller. It was, that wasn't good. By the way, really quick, rapid fire, we do play Notre Dame right out the gate.
Mm-hmm.
A little Notre Dame action. I was pleased that we added a little UMass action to the schedule of the non-conference.
Did you see what the price tag on that game was?
Mm-mm.
1.5 mil.
Come get your ass whooping.
It was like break-even weekend.
Get your ass kicking. That's an automatic win. Jacksonville State ought to be on an automatic win. Tough to find other automatic wins with this group, right? I mean, you're not going to assume a win against NC State and North Carolina and Wake. And yeah, no. Got work to do. Can we get to 500, Tom?
I wonder if those opponents are going to be still locked in that way because of the shuffling of opponents this year. Does that mean that your cross-conference opponent, like North Carolina, I don't care, we beat them this year, so what if we have to play them again? But, you know, do they change that because this season's schedule looked drastically different than it was going to back in January of last year?
Do not know. I know they want to try to get to some semblance of normalcy again, and I do think we'll be playing, for example, you know, Florida in Florida, in Gainesville. I know a lot of people think, well, it was our turn. Nah, I don't think we're doing that. I don't think we're upsetting the apple cart and asking other programs to change up their whole scheduling for the whatever foreseeable future. I don't think it's going to work that way.
You don't think they're going to make Clemson come down here because they screwed themselves out of that game?
I don't. I think we're going to be going up there to get beat. It's Jeff Cameron, Show 97.9, ESPN Radio. who are thinking about it, because you probably have been over the holidays, and we all know we stuffed our face, got after it, had some fun, enjoyed the downtime as best we could. But now you're kind of focused on the new year, doing right for you, your family, your business, whatever it might be, and that includes being of sound mind and, in all likelihood, the best shape that you could be in. I would invite you to enjoy a little Orange Theory Fitness. I go virtually every day. Had a great workout today yet again. I also know that right now they're offering up huge savings. That's, you know, your typical standard kind of commercial format. You know, hey, huge savings now. Take advantage. But in all honesty, it is, because if you sign up for 3 months, you get a month for free. So if you were thinking about doing it, you're going to save a lot of money. I just want to talk to those that are kind of kicking it around their head. I feel safe there. You're spaced out, minimum 6 feet. I never really feel like I'm in close contact to people where I'm uncomfortable. You can wear a mask while you work out there if you want. You don't have to if you don't want to either. And the way that they've set up the cleaning system between classes, you can learn a lot more. If you want, reach out to me. I'll give you more details on that. But I just want you to take advantage of two things: the free month if you sign up now for 3 months, and then the other thing is they're doing this OTF in-body challenge where you, and I got on the machine. That's a humbling exercise, Tom, to get on the machine, because then they it gauges your degree of body fat, your body fat percentage. So you know the areas where you have good muscle mass and where you're weak, areas where, you know, you could probably lose weight and increase muscle mass. And they go everything from skeletal muscle mass and everything else, body fat mass, everything in there. You learn a lot about how your body is built, and we're all different. So we all have trouble areas, if you will. When I eat too much, drink too much, it goes to my fat face, Tom. My fat face. It gets out of control. Everything else, I'm pretty good. But it's right there in the cheeks. I get puffy.
We all have cheeks somewhere on our body.
Somewhere on our body.
More than just the usual places.
So, you know, there's a lot of good stuff here that I could tell you more about. If you want to find out more, go to orangetheoryfitness.com, but I would sign up today. All right, tonight's national championship game, real quick. If you want to think about, and we were like this, you'll remember, we were like this. 2013, this is who we were. And maybe we didn't really take the time to reflect on that for a moment. But when Alabama lines up, you think about this. It's a pretty cool situation that they find themselves in. Their players, reading this morning on ESPN.com, Bill Connelly, their offensive players have won the most outstanding overall player, Devontae Smith, best quarterback, Mac Jones, running back, Najee Harris, receiver, Smith again, lineman, Alex Weatherwood, center, Landon Dickerson. He's not going to play tonight. Overall offensive line was graded out as the best in the country. And you look at the numbers, in terms of efficiency, this offense is right there with LSU in terms of efficiency. And that was an offense we thought was the best of all time. To be mentioned in the same breath of that offense we watched a year ago is staggering. Some of the other numbers that stand out. This is from Sports Info Solution. So, anything that falls under the umbrella of RPO, they enjoy a 63% success rate. They gain 9.9 yards per play when they run their RPOs. When they throw from motion at the snap, 68% success rate, 9.1 yards per play. Both are top 15 numbers. When they go straight up play action, old-fashioned style play action that we all know and love, they have nearly a 60%, 59.4 success rate, top 10 in the country, and 10.4 yards per play, top 10 in the country. Really, anything they do offensively, Tom, motion, no motion, RPO, no RPO, straight play action, straight drop back, yeah, their scripts are pretty much perfect. You can do anything you want.
A first down every play, it would seem.
Just about.
And that's the thing that happened against Notre Dame is pre-snap, what Mac Jones was able to do was diagnose it. Notre Dame didn't disguise it, and so he made immediate decisions. As soon as the ball was snapped, immediate decisions throwing to wide-open guys. The question is, does Ohio State confuse him at all tonight? And I always say it every year. It's on television tonight. I'm sure it'll be on ESPNU. I haven't confirmed that, though. If you can watch the camera, the spider cam, the wire cam over the quarterback, it gives you a great indication of are they fooled or are they seeing what they expect to see after the ball is snapped. And that's the number one key. If Ohio State does it just a little bit, maybe Ohio State's offense is good enough against an Alabama defense that isn't great.
Up and down.
To put them ahead. Put them ahead by a score or two, and then Alabama has to answer rather than set the pace.
Your hope is, because you're just rooting for a really good game, is, and you know, somewhat of a disinterested party. What I mean by that is that you don't have a rooting interest tonight, I don't think. I mean, most Florida State fans are probably about damn tired of seeing these two teams. Just like if Clemson were there, you'd be like, eh, whatever. So you just want to see a good game because you're a football fan. And you'd like to watch a really compelling national championship game. And we've seen some doozies, some really good ones. And so I suspect we got a shot at it tonight if what happens plays out the way that you're talking about, where there's just a minimum of confusion caused by this Ohio State defense, which gives them a small opening to have success, obviously, offensively, to get to the number that they're going to have to get to make this a game. What I mean by that is you are not going to hold Alabama down, period. You're not. You're going to give up big plays. You're going to give up scores. You have to do enough that that number you're racing towards is obtainable. So if that number is 40, and it might be,
right,
do you get enough stops to keep that in range? And I think they've got a shot at doing that because this is a roster from a personnel standpoint and from a recruiting ranking standpoint over the last 5 years that says yes. It's also a roster that when you look at all of the websites that project the draft in the next year, that says Alabama is facing a team across from them. It's not quite Spider-Man pointing at you, pointing back at me, but it's close. It's really close. So they have a lot of NFL players.
Yeah, the question is, can Fields make the 2 to 3 plays again in this game that are just otherworldly, that right, nobody else can make? Because he has to go above and beyond what the scheme demands and what he sees before him. Orlovsky did a great job. I go back and forth on him. Sometimes he's great,
sometimes
he's a doofus.
When he breaks down quarterback play, he's fine on the film.
Right.
When he's being asked to say salacious things for the point of argument, you roll your eyes.
So yesterday, after Baltimore and Tennessee is over, he breaks down the Lamar Jackson touchdown run, and he talks about how the defense is perfect. The call is perfect, and it's just Lamar Jackson making a play because they had two safeties hovering in the robber area, and they've got the angles. It's just you don't get an angle on Lamar if he's in.
It's the first part of that run when he breaks through the lane and the safety comes
right
up.
31's got no chance.
Got no chance.
Right. But that is a player going above and beyond and making an extra play. That's what Fields did against Clemson.
Yeah.
He's going to have to do that again tonight at least a couple of times. Alabama doesn't have to have it. Ohio State does.
That is correct.
Meaning Mac Jones doesn't have to go make 2 or 3 plays in this game that you go, oh, well, I mean,
correct.
He's just transcending at the moment right now. They don't need that.
They don't.
Ohio State does.
He's a really good player. He's done a really good job. It's so hard when you get a kid in an offense that is all-time great, and he puts up great numbers, as he did. I mean, they're all-time numbers. You kind of have a tendency, I think we all do, to say, well, how much of that is him making plays? How much of that is being surrounded by the most unique set of offensive players in the country? Well, it's both. It's both. You still have to be able to make throws. You still have to be able to make plays. And he does. He's not devoid of the ability, right, to make a play here and there. And that's really what makes them lethal, because if he was just your standard manage the game quarterback, he would be really successful in this offense. You've got an elite offensive line, elite running back, two to three elite receivers. You're going to be successful. But he does more than that, just a little bit more. They don't need him to all the time,
right,
as you're rightly pointing out, but he does. And then you're just like, well, okay, so you're going to make that throw? You're going to make the throw where we actually have it really well covered, and you're going to drop it into the backside shoulder and, you know.
Oh, I'm not saying he's not capable. Yeah, I agree with you.
We're
in agreement here.
That's the frustrating aspect is what I'm saying. Like, when you face that, you're like, really? We did everything right here, and you're going to make that throw? Well, you're an ass. You know what I mean? You don't need, what in the world are we doing here? You know, that's so frustrating for them, for the teams that have to face Alabama, because when he's right, he makes plays in addition to managing the game and being surrounded by elite talent and all those things. Fields played the best game he'll ever play the last game. There's no way that he'll play better than that tonight. There is zero chance that happens. Can he play as well? Maybe. I doubt it, but maybe. He was unreal.
But he might be able to put up numbers commensurate to it because he's facing a worse defense.
He might. They really torched Venables. That was something. They had his ass in the jackpot.
You know, now, next year, everybody's going to do the same thing when it comes to being covert about their calls and getting to the line and either calling it late or right up against the clock. That's an interesting move on the chessboard, because Venables will have to answer for it now. There'll be some games where it doesn't matter, but there might be some others where maybe it matters where it wouldn't have before.
Most of the time it won't, because the teams that effectively try to employ that don't have the personnel to take advantage to the tune of Ohio State's personnel like they did. Ohio State's personnel is explosive, and so when they took advantage of those opportunities, those were house calls. A lot of schools, Boston College, Florida State, we don't have the ability necessarily to turn that into instant points.
However, Boston College was putting it on Clemson earlier this season, yeah. And then there was the second half rally. Boston College needed to score one time in the second half. Does a concept like this afford a team like that on a day in which they've already gotten lucky for the first half? Can they validate with that one, you know, 7-point drive and the game's over because the deficit's too big? That gets fun, because that would mean that there really is – Drago is bleeding in Clemson. He is bleeding. He's cut, and it's a bad cut.
I would just say this. Even though we've already got a glimpse of the elite-level play that their backup quarterback at Clemson was capable of this year, the big son bitch, as he's known, it is impossible to – it is highly unlikely that Clemson is going to get – preternatural quarterback play for the ninth year in a row. I mean, I got to believe at some point we're going to see them take a step back at the position. I can't think of too many programs in the history of college football that have had the talent commiserate to Deshaun Watson and Trevor Lawrence in back-to-back runs. That's dumb. I think it should be illegal. I think it probably was obtained illegally. And I think we've all suffered greatly because of it. Final hour, forthcoming. Stay with. Final hour of the Jeff Cameron Show, at least for today. Appreciate you tuning on in. Hope you're well. Hope you had a great weekend. Hope you're getting geared up. Sit back, watch a little college football tonight. The conclusion, they crossed the finish line. National championship, Alabama, Ohio State. By the way, we're online, ESPNTallahassee.com. That's where you go to listen live. We get a streaming free. Hello, YouTubers. Hope this finds you doing well. If you'd like to email us, you can, JCS@979ESPNradio.com. On Twitter, it's at Jay Cameron Show. What a way to end the run of Park Your Ass games Saturday and Sunday. Last night's conclusion was an emphatic screw you to the Steelers and the Steelers' way of life, which used to be bully ball, run the football, physical. You're not going to roll into Pittsburgh and just do whatever you want. Cleveland did whatever they wanted. They played the role of bully. A lot of teams did in the second half of the season. Steelers are looking at a rebuild because Ben Roethlisberger sucks. The time is up. You hate to see it happen because, and I say that, I'm not a big fan of the man himself, but I would say that in solely gauging what he's been as a player, he's a Hall of Famer, won a couple Super Bowls, and you know, is an all-time great. That player does not resemble this player. That player is in a distant memory position at this point in his career. So I think they got to obviously draft quarterback or look elsewhere to bring one in. I know he's got another year on his contract. I got to give him credit. He was humble last night after that loss, saying, I don't know if they want me back. I apologize to the team, we'll have some discussions. Those discussions will be about whether or not he comes back at the dollar amount. Yeah, there's no way you pay him what he's scheduled to make, which is the most amount of money under the cap of any player in the league. So there's no chance that I would do that. I'd say you're going to take this pay cut or you can get the hell up out of here. That's not the focus of the hour, but it was the conclusion of the weekend. Tonight, obviously, the national championship game. The big stories of the weekend locally are what Florida State did in the transfer portal. I'll get to that momentarily. Had a good discussion about it last hour in the first and second segments of the hour with Ira Chappell, and then Tom and I followed up on that. So you want more meatier stuff on that, you can go back and hear that hour when the show concludes as well. But I do want to say, I was a little disappointed because I had built it up in my head that we were going to get great game after great game after great game. We really didn't. The Buffalo Indy game did turn out to be really, really good.
It was wacky, yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of a weird game. I also thought that the Titans-Ravens was a weird game. We both thought the Ravens would win that game. It didn't get off to that kind of start. They're down 10-0, facing a 3rd-and-7, and Jackson makes the play. That doesn't get talked about enough. The run for the touchdown is what everybody talks about because that's pretty amazing. The run to buy time to the right sideline to drift to your right under pressure, 3rd-and-17 to make that third and seven to make that throw to pick up 17 yards. That's an insane throw. That throw is against your body on a laser to Andrews, and that play is amazing.
And it's not a defensive interior guy that's chasing him. It's a secondary. Remember the secondary. So it's somebody who can get there and somebody who can do something about it. And he had been bottled up all day.
Oh, he'd been completely shut down. He was about to be the third straight 3-and-out.
I thought, oh no, what are you doing? And then it was, oh.
I said the same thing. I said, what are you doing? That's a laser. Nice throw. Listen, as a passer, he's still got a long ways to go. He is sometimes good, sometimes bad. He's always electrifying if he makes you miss and you're in man. They were in man, and next thing you knew, peace out.
Can we talk about how the Sharps got that game wrong completely? They never get games wrong by 22 points. But they said that the over-under, the total points in that game was going to be in the mid-50s.
Yeah, I think they thought the Titans would do a lot more than score 10 points. And it sure looked like they would be. But it's odd. When they got off script, it reminded me of Florida State. When they got off script, completely shut down in that game.
Well, the front seven for Baltimore, time and time again, they filled. They played unselfish.
They hit Derrick Henry hard, too. It was impressive.
I'll tell you what, I'm withdrawing my nomination for Derrick Henry as MVP because the look in his eyes yesterday was somebody who didn't want to be there. And that can never happen.
No, it was weird. He got hit hard on his first three runs. Baltimore wanted to send a message early. We're not about it today. We'll hit you. And they did.
Short of an 8-yard gain in the second half, other than that, he did not run with purpose. Once he saw that what he's used to and accustomed to seeing
is not going to happen,
and Baltimore's going to take it away from you, he changed. His whole mentality was different, and Vrabel didn't leave that early enough. He didn't leave it soon enough. He should have let Tannehill throw. The first 11 throws, Tannehill's averaging almost 10 yards an attempt.
Yeah. Well, I give credit to Baltimore. It seemed like once Lamar – was able to make that throw. Now, keep in mind, they only went down and kicked a field goal, and that made it 10-3. But I felt like that took the weight of the world off his back. He played free the rest of the game. You know, I also think, you know, you just continue to see Harbaugh call games aggressively. I know they ended up getting a false start penalty, but it's fourth or an offensive pass interference penalty, but it was 4th and 2, and he's going for it. Well, he's going to win the game. He's saying, I'm going to win the game. You know, I want to go win this game right now.
I don't know about that call either.
But you got to be who you are and what they, oh, the play, the penalty is bad. He chicken wing though. That if he doesn't chicken wing, they don't call it.
He did, but they never showed the replay. That was an awful broadcast, by the way, yesterday. And also, they tried to do the film room thing. That was terrible also.
I didn't watch the film room thing.
Oh, my God. It was.
I saw an angle where he chicken wings, and the officials will always tell you, you have got to make it as if you're catching a football. So if he puts his arm straight out and sticks his butt back, like he's making a play.
Yeah.
You're fine on that, but he chicken winged.
But the replay I'm talking about, I just want to see where the depth of the catch is. Did Dobbins catch that 2-3 yards down the field?
Yeah,
or what?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was?
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't at the line of scrimmage?
No, no, he got over. He got over. Yeah. Right. So he's there. But the point is they end up having to settle for the field goal. They end up getting the stops. They win the game. Good for Lamar. I think he's still got a long ways to go as a passer. Some days he looks electrifying. And my problem with him as a passer is not between the numbers. It's outside the numbers. He doesn't make a lot of great throws outside the numbers. That maybe will come. He's 24 years old. Certainly, I'll trade that given that he's the most dynamic quarterback in the league when he's running. And there's no getting around that. And that's why he rushed for over 100 yards. And listen, you'll take 17 of 24 for $1.79. He had a terrible pick in that game that put him behind the 8-ball. But if you're going to run for $1.36... Okay.
He called it a dumbass pick in his post-game interview, and he goes, oops, sorry.
That made me laugh, by the way. He was right about that. The Bucs get a win in a playoff game for the first time in 13 years, right? No,
since the 18, Super Bowl.
18 yeah. since a win. I forgot about that. 18 years since a win. It was the first time they'd been to a playoff in 13 years. So there you go. That's why can't get too mad with the ugly nature in with which you win it. I would say Tom Brady, man, golly. It's just, how in the world is he that good against that defense? 381 yards. He is the only reason the Bucs move on. He was electrifying. Fournette was good, too. So this is why you brought him in. This is why you brought him in. And he's now having to win games because this defense sucks. So that's where we're at.
The way they protected on the edges. I mean, Gronk was an absolute man beast. Wirfs was great. Donovan Smith played largely well. The way they protected along the perimeter gives me hope that Cam Jordan won't be able to operate and do whatever the hell he wants this
week.
Let's hope.
Yeah, I mean,
changes things.
Well, this becomes an interesting game for a lot of reasons. A, can the Bucs break the cycle of losses against the Saints? And B, can they get enough stops against a pedestrian-looking these days offense in New Orleans? Let's not forget, much of this game yesterday against Chicago saw what looked to be a well-below-average offense. New Orleans didn't look good. Drew Brees didn't look good. Nothing about what they were doing on offense against the Bears looked good. The Bears' defense, I dare say, is better than the Bucs' defense, and I don't know that the Bucs can dictate terms the way the Bears dictated terms, and the Bears were doing that with absolutely nothing from their quarterback on the other side, so they were bound to get worn out. The second half, the Saints were better. They only had the ball 3 times in the second half. 3 total, the Saints did. They were all long drives for touchdowns, so what are you going to do? I think you got a fighting chance because I don't think their offense is nearly as dynamic as it has been in years past. But then again, I think you're in deep trouble because your defense isn't great to take advantage of that. And their defense is really good in New Orleans. And I know Brady's playing exceptionally well right now. But, man, I think that's an awful lot to ask to go on the road and put, what, 30 up against that defense?
It might be able to. We'll see what happens at right guard because Cap is out, and it might not be Ted Larson. It might be somebody else starting this
week. I think it's going
week.
To be somebody else.
But that would be something where the twist game might get you, but their strength is on the perimeter of that defensive line, and just seeing the way the Bucs put that plan in action, leaving 6 and 7 guys in routinely.
Smart.
And Brady was all over the place. I mean, he was moving all over the different so facets good. Of the pocket, creating the angles for himself.
And imagine if Chris Godwin bothers to play like Chris Godwin. What in the hell was that drop festival?
I have no idea.
I've never seen anything like it.
But that was Brady's best game as a Buck by far. There's not even a close second. That was a phenomenal performance.
Yeah, he's been really good for 5 straight weeks. He's been really good. He's playing better now than he played at the start of the season. Part of that is getting used to the offense and incorporating the aspects that he wants and maybe, you know, kind of dialing back aspects that he doesn't like. Part of that is getting to where you have a symbiotic relationship with your tight ends, your receivers. I get all of that. Fournette helps him a lot, too. Fournette was really good in this game. That's surprising to me, I have to admit, but he's come on lately. I would say, by the way, good for Cameron Brate, man. Good for you, buddy. You were a star in this game, an absolute beast. He won one-on-one matchups, and Washington was betting that he couldn't. And I would have bet the same thing. That was the smart thing. Okay, Gronk's going to be kept in as a blocker because he's great. When he goes out, we're going to have Bostic cover him. We're going to be okay there. Brate can't hurt us. We're too athletic. Brate killed them. He was fantastic. And Evans was good, too, playing hurt. That was great to see. Godwin, I mean, is too good a player for that to happen 2 weeks in a row. I got to believe that he just – maybe he was nervous.
But I set the over-under at – was it 2.5? Is that – how many times you're going to see Brady have enough time where you go, whoa.
Yeah, it
was
incredible.
He's got all day. He's well over 2.5 in that game.
Yeah, they actually – they were really, really good. Really good. Something else great happened in this game that is more important as we talk about progress than the girl who kicked at Vandy. And that was Lori Locus, Washington's Jennifer King, and Tampa's Morel Jabedifar in making history as the only three, first playoff game, I should say, in history to have women on both coaching staffs go through and win a play, participate against one another in a playoff game as coaches on the field of NFL games. How cool is that? That is a much bigger step forward than the girl at Vandy who kicked the extra points. Nothing against her. I got no problem with that. That's great. But that had been done before in a non-Power 5 game 20 years prior. This is a bigger deal. This, to me, is a much bigger deal.
For me, moving forward for the Bucs, here's the thing about the defense. Now that you don't have a mobile quarterback, you might perform better. The Heinicke was all over the damn place.
He was incredible.
You know, only two or three players graded out higher on Pro Football Focus. I get it. Than Tom Brady. One of them was Heinicke. I mean, are you kidding me?
Yeah, I was growing frustrated. I really feel like if Alex Smith plays in that game, the Bucs blow Washington out. But he doesn't. The problem, though, Tom, is I understand he played great. And sometimes it's a one-off, and you weren't prepared for it. You didn't have a lot of film on him, so maybe he did things you didn't expect him to be able to do. He's a backup quarterback in a nothing league. That shouldn't happen. He made it look too easy. I'm still really growing very concerned about a couple of things. Our inability to create real pressure bothers me to no end. Also, what the hell's going on with Shaq Barrett? He made a play the first play of the game. Useless the rest of the game. Wasn't around. You didn't even know he's on the field. They've got problems. There's something wrong with JPP. They got problems.
For Barrett, I don't know if he had coronavirus or if it was a close contact, but if he actually had COVID-19, you've seen players, it takes a while. They say that, you know, it might be a week or two before they get fully up to speed. Alvin Kamara yesterday was nothing compared to what he typically is, and I know for a fact that he did have the virus. So maybe that's it. But Devin White's value as somebody who comes up
massively
and makes plays
difference, yeah.
Around the line of scrimmage on the flare routes.
That'll be a huge deal.
Pressure rates, sack rates, quarterback pressures. Yes, having him back this week is massive for Tampa. They missed him terribly.
I think so. And any game you watch where he's not in, you notice it immediately because you just don't see that blur flying to the line of scrimmage on any of the quick game plays or any of the outside zone runs, any of the flares. When you watch a Buck game and he's playing, those things are taken away violently.
Yeah, Minter is okay for a drive.
He's a good backup.
You know, if somebody's hurt or somebody just needs a breather, but not for the whole course of a game. I mean, no. You saw how many times was he isolated or David isolated, and you're like, man, they would have Devin in this situation. I mean, like probably 6 or 7
yeah,
times.
Oh,
where,
yeah.
Again, Washington is alert. They're doing everything they can.
Yeah.
But then also Heinicke improvises and makes 3 or 4 plays where you're like, all right, dude, all right, fine. Breeze ain't going to do that. So the question is, do they cover a little bit more aggressively this week? Because the underneath stuff, we thought that they were going to come up and challenge. They didn't do it again.
I keep waiting on it. My feelings towards Coach Bowles have changed a lot over the course of this season. I've gone from being completely head over heels in love to we'll move along.
Will there be personnel within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage when the ball's in the air? That's the question.
Kind of important.
Weekend.
Hey, real quick, I know we're getting to all the games here. I do want to point to something that, you know, and I tweeted about it the other night. Man, how great is it to watch Cam Akers in the second half of this season? It's like he had to get his sea legs in the NFL, had to kind of figure some things out in the NFL. A lot of guys do at receiver and running back. Holes close a lot faster in the NFL. Guys hit a lot harder in the NFL more consistently. There is no sort of, unless you're one of these rare guys like a Le'Veon Bell in years past that can kind of delay and sort of pause and wait and hide behind offensive linemen. And even then, you're in a unique situation with a dominant offensive line that lets you do it. Most of the time in the NFL, you got to hit that thing right now. And those who don't, you get frustrated with. Well, I think in the second half of the season, what you saw when he was fully healthy and understood the speed of the game, was the electrifying player we saw here in Tallahassee without an offensive line, right? That's who he was, and he was incredible. The Rams, for that game, rushed for 164 yards. That defense knew it was coming because there was not going to be elite quarterback play from the Rams, so they had to know it was coming. And that allowed the Rams to possess the ball for 34, 35 minutes of that game. That was a huge part of why they won. I'm going to read you a quote from Sean McVay, who's a great coach. The key was being able to be physical up front. Cam Akers is the star of this game. In terms of offensively, being able to be strong, sturdy, get tough yards for us, being able to control possessions. He made all those plays. I thought the biggest play of the game in terms of momentum, one of the bigger plays, was the check down where Jared moved into the pocket, found Cam for a big explosive play on third down and long. Cam was our MVP. Good. There you go. There you go.
Well, and it mirrors his freshman year here. Because remember, by the time he got to the beginning of November, he turned on, he looked like a different running back. You're like, oh, so that's why everybody heralded this dude as the next one. And it took him a lot more carries to get to 1,000 yards, but he did as a freshman here. And here's where it gets fun. Because of the matchup at Lambeau, earlier this year, one of the best single game performances by any player in the National Football League was Dalvin Cook at Lambeau when he went for over two Bills, all purpose. Could it be that two Florida State running backs in the same season go into that building and come out with a star performance?
Are they going to get enough in a cold weather game, and it is going to be cold, from Jared Goff to be in a position to utilize Cam Akers? Because if I'm Green Bay, I'm walking up to the line of scrimmage and saying, you ain't got nothing. Yeah, throw it over my head consistently in this weather, Jared. Throw it over my head.
Well, but here's the good news is you've got Ramsey to take out Adams, and they're missing their left tackle, Bakhtiari, who's out for the season. But how's Aaron Donald? Because apparently he's got rib cartilage issues.
Yeah, they got to shoot him up, and he's a tough SOB. He'll take the shot. For him to go down in the third quarter early, be out the rest of the game, and for them to get the production they did from their backups was huge. We worried about Seattle going into the postseason. Their offense had begun to sputter. They became a much better defensive team than offensive team, which was the 180 from what we saw in the first half of the season. And they were going against the league's best defense, the most elite cover corner in the league, who will tell you about it. The Rams have largely, it's funny, while we're praising Cam Akers and we're talking about the FSU influence on a team and the postseason in general, well, I don't know that anybody influences an overall team mentality, especially on that side of the ball defensively, than Jalen Ramsey does. Nobody does it more than he does. The way he affects the rest of that unit, you see it. I mean, that guy is, he walks it like he talks it. They follow his lead.
It's a matchup with the two best corners in the game because Jair Alexander's numbers actually look a little bit better than Ramsey's this season. But when you're talking about overall impact on a team inspiration beyond
and the
just the numbers.
The physicality of Jalen is just unreal.
Well, and if Adams is out of it, and it's a, I mean, we'll see what the weather report is as the week shakes out. This could get really interesting really fast in the
NFC. Also a matchup I really want to see because I would normally bet on Jalen Ramsey to win that matchup, but I'm not so sure. Adams has been so good this year. We'll see. It's not a slam dunk that he dominates that matchup. That's how good Adams has been. Let's just put it that way. Metcalf had a 50-something yard touchdown in this game. And
he did. It was a broken play, and that was a little frustrating because, you know, I thought Tyler Lockett would be the person who grabs the targets.
I was about to ask you about that. How'd that work out for you?
Not good. No, my first overall pick was Derrick Henry. Game over.
Tough day at the office for Derek.
Yes, it was. And Mike Vrabel had to chase him down and say, find your heart, son. I mean, Jesus.
They needed a lot more, too. That was weird because Corey Adams went out. And then, you know, Adams was great, by the way.
Yeah. Davis? Corey Davis?
Davis. Yeah. Corey Davis went out. When I say Corey Adams. Yeah, Corey Davis went out. That hurt in the last quarter of the game, but
they came out throwing the ball well, and they were being dared to, and they just stopped doing it.
Two obvious things here. I haven't touched on the Bills win, which is great. That was the best game of the weekend, but also point out something, man. Those are two offensive pass interference early in the game that they're just not going to call. He's just shoving your boy to the ground.
Oh, I know.
It's like, this is, well, goodness gracious.
Well, and this was an all-timer of a weekend. NFL coaches are all, they have their blind spots, and they're massive blind spots, like giant rods in the side of your car. But Mike Vrabel's punt, Mike Tomlin's punt.
Fourth and two.
Bruce Arians going for two for no freaking reason.
Well, that's dumbassery beyond belief. There's no reason whatsoever.
Sean Payton calling a Taysom Hill pass when they're moving the ball just fine. What happens? A short field turnover?
Well,
you got to prove to everybody how smart you are, pal.
Well, he wanted to take a shot. He can't take a shot with his pop gun arm guy, so he brought him in.
And it's another instance where it's open. It's 54 crow hops before the ball comes out loose, but... Sean, that's what happens when you don't put your best player in the position to execute a play.
Saints have to win it all this year. Going into next season, now they'll manipulate this before the numbers come out. They're close to $100 million over the cap. They've put all of the chips to the middle of the table. It's now or never, or certainly not in the next 6 years. So this is it. This is the run. They lose this weekend to the Bucs. Get ready for a bunch of 6-10 seasons.
Who's the pressure on this week?
Right. Well, again... I actually think the season so far for the Bucs now is a success because I also always viewed this as a two-year thing, and I still do, probably more so than I did because I don't think I thought this guy would look this good this late.
This is where I'd agree that I'm not revising it. It's always Super Bowl or bust when you have Tom Brady, but I feel better about year two because, as you're saying, he's gotten better as the season's
gone. That's weird. It's weird to see a guy get better as the season goes on at his age.
The pressure's on the home team.
Oh, I think so.
The pressure's not on Tom Brady. Go figure.
The cap situation is such that it, by definition, means the Saints need to win this. Now, I don't blame them for going all in and anteing up. I mean, this is the time to do it. You've got a squad. You've got an elite defense. You've got a great offensive line. You've got a transcendent running back.
Oh, they should win this game. Absolutely.
Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. You know, circling back to something we talked about last hour involving Florida State improving the defensive end position, improving the football team with the use of the transfer portal. On the one hand, you really should be excited about the upgrades that they've made at key positions. On the other hand, it's funny because as I was looking at the names and I went back through and looked at their production in college, what they were thought of as they came out of high school, their rankings and recruiting, all of that, you kind of use that and apply it as you're addressing Florida State's class to say, what would they have been ranked, right? What would they have been? And again, class rankings matter to a large extent if in over time you're building consensus top five classes. Your margin for error is greater, and you're going to have a greater depth of talent. That's true. But in a singular season like this one, I'm just looking for, did you get a better caliber defensive end? Did you get a better caliber wide receiver? Did you get a better player that's played college football? We have tape. We've seen them go against good competition in Power 5 leagues. Are those better players than what we have at that position? That's what I'm doing. And the answer, at least with the defensive ends and tackles, is a resounding yes. Yes, they are improved from what they were. And I think that's very important because those are two areas of great need. Now, linebacker play here has been sorry as hell, so you're still going to be average at best at linebacker. Obviously, you don't have a depth of talent at wide receiver right now. You've certainly aided your ability to give Mackenzie Milton somebody to throw to by bringing in Parchman, but you don't have an elite receiving core. I think you've got added depth at running back. There's no doubt that that should help you. Stylistically, you're better off too. You got a bruiser to go along with some of the speed guys.
I'm going to miss watching Webb.
This is a thicker version of Webb, though.
Yeah.
So, okay. And I do think that, you know, if you marry these things along with, as I said earlier, a real off season and the opportunity to have a spring and an install that is more along the lines of what every coaching staff is afforded the opportunity to have in their first year when they come in and try to flip a program's roster as well as mindset. And so, yeah, they're going to be a better football team. Bringing in Kerr Thomas and Jermaine Johnson, that's a difference-making effort from Florida State. I'll be very curious to see if they get a tackle, offensive tackle, maybe after spring is over. They expect some more guys to put their name in. If that happens, good, because I think you need that upgrade there, too. I think you could really improve your offensive line, and I think it's necessary, especially if Mackenzie Milton's going to be your quarterback and he's not nearly the dynamic runner that he was at UCF, and we assume he is not. Now, maybe he can surprise me. By the way, really what I'm saying here is how excited are you for spring football? I know it's a ways down the road, and tonight college football concludes, and our minds are on who's going to win the national championship and what a distant land those two teams seem to occupy from Florida State currently. But if you can get that past that part of it and really hyper-focus on just the climb, well, you know, Florida State got better with these moves. They did. I don't know if they're vastly improved by the addition of Jamie Robinson from South Carolina. South Carolina's defense sucked this year. You're bringing in a kid from a defense that sucked. That doesn't mean he sucks, but that defense wasn't any good. And that's by every measure. You can go look at any number you want. And, you know, I would say to you, he's probably an average football player at this level. He's an average Power 5 safety. He's not an elite safety. But you're not going to get an elite safety. You'd have to get lucky. The circumstances would be really weird for you to get an elite player at any position to come to Florida State if they've only got 1 or 2 years to play and they have options to go to schools that are already successful, already in a position to win and win now. So you're not going to get those guys. So I think he gives you depth. You're kind of talented. You got some talent at safety anyhow. So you're just probably adding depth there.
The thing I'd say about spring football and summer football, the workouts that are voluntary in name only, they're critical. I mean, we all know that. We learned that last year.
Yeah.
The hard way. But if you're going to bring these many or this many new players at these many positions, right? Well, here's the problem. Mackenzie Milton has to get on the same page with all of the running backs, especially considering the concept of this offense. He's going to have to get on the same page with Cameron McDonald and Jordan Wilson and Parchment and the receivers that are here on already on the roster. So you've got to have all of these things on offense, and defensively the same way. These guys have to get used to playing with one another. So whenever spring starts, it needs to finish with the full amount of practices, the full allotment of practices. This much turnover means it's all the more critical. It might be more critical than last year to get all of this extra work and development in.
Well, I think they're going to get largely normal, in terms of totals, practices. I think they're going to get that.
I hope so, given the if spring practice starts when it usually does, then you've got a chance that you might be pausing some things, or some guys might be out for reasons that they wouldn't be in the summer. That's where, again, we're coming back to this point of, if you can delay it, push it back as far as possible to give yourself the best chance for more contact drills, for less stoppages because of contact tracing, this spring is so critical. I mean, what is it, like 30-40% of the roster that's turned over since he took the job and he was at the podium a year and a half?
It's crazy.
13 months ago.
It had to happen. We wondered how that would look. We wondered what that process would look like, right? It's always hard to know. When you're going through that kind of transition and you're flipping a roster and a culture, you think, well, how many of those kids that exist on the roster currently whose athleticism you could utilize, can you get to buy in and then be leaders themselves of the new buy-in, of the new way of doing things? Can they pull everybody else along and lead by example? Because they're the ones that would be most immediately respected. They've played a lot of college football. They've got talent. They buy in. That means the transition begins now. Usually, though, that doesn't happen. It's a coach's best wish. It's what they hope for. It's what they long for. It's what they try to speak into existence. See our last head coach, Willie Taggart, tried to speak to the ACC assembled media when we were up in Charlotte, telling everybody how that was not a locker room full of turds, was the word he used. That he thought they were good kids that just needed an arm put around them. Well, they were average from a talent standpoint, and they never really did buy in. He didn't do a good job of winning them over, and it turns out a lot of those guys were not good for the culture. And I think Norvell was hoping, certainly, that, okay, I'm going to have my one-on-one meetings with these guys. I'm going to sit across from them. I'm going to lay it out before them. This is the deal. This is the new way of doing things. It's going to be hard. It's not going to be easy. I'm going to be incredibly upfront with you. If you want to leave, I understand. I'll sign the papers, but if you stay, I promise you'll be a better man for it. And I appreciated that approach. I think that's the right idea, is to treat people like you'd want to be treated, honestly, straightforward, as a man, like an adult. These are adults, technically. So, yeah, you would want to do that. But even that didn't work. As we found out, it didn't work. The first sign of adversity, those kids who were quote-unquote bought in, they weren't bought in anymore. You know, once the losses mounted, they weren't bought in anymore. So, in truth, most of the time, the only way you can get to where you want to go in flipping the culture and flipping the roster is to go through massive change and upheaval, and that's never conducive to winning. It's always going to be a problem on the field while you're going through those transformations off it, let alone throw some COVID on top of that ass. You got no shot. So there we were, COVID-ridden, broken, not talented. There was no chance to win.
Throw some COVID on top of that ass.
So there it is. So now we got the transformation. It sucks, but it's part of the process. And I know people roll their eyes at that, because how many times are you going to be beat over the head with process? But it's true.
And that's where having Jimbo as the head coach in waiting was that you were able to smooth that process out and have a season like 2010 where, yeah, there were losses, but you felt good about where the program was going. You know, the process looked okay. It looked healthy. You were bringing in players. Like, the relationships that needed to be formed were. Here, you're starting cold. And he didn't even get to really start.
Yeah.
If it's a 100-meter dash, you ran 5, and they're like, stop, hang on a minute.
Yeah. No, you didn't
let
really
you know when you can run again.
It was frustrating.
And he's still waiting.
It was frustrating. But, you know, I feel better today than I did, going back to, say, right after the Pitt game when we got our ass destroyed. That was a tough day.
Or the NC State game.
Well, either way.
Giving cushions into the back of the end zone. Third and goal. All right. I want you to be at the top of the lettering, young man.
Did you see our mutual friend, Tim Linnefelt, formerly of Seminoles.com? Did you see his tweet last night when the Steelers were down 28-0?
Oh, about the PA guy?
That was good.
It is good.
It's 28-0, and my man wants you to know it's third down.
The worst one's in New Orleans.
Oh, yeah.
That guy shouts at the top of his lungs every time to an empty building.
It's a toughie. Well, he's playing a role. Everybody's got their part, Tom.
I'm going to give it an honest day's work.
He's been there forever. That's the same guy that's been there forever. I recognize that voice anywhere. He's been there for as long as I've been covering sports.
I don't recognize it as much because the people just get loud, and so they're kind of drowned out, and everybody does it. Can we come up with something different? Like, what, anything different?
Anything
other than the third down or fourth down yelling when it's those two downs. Like, and can we just eliminate it altogether and say third down and let the people do it themselves? Because I can't stand when New England plays the goal horn or Buffalo hits the train siren on third down. It's like, we all know you don't need it.
I like when the Vikings do the horn.
Well, that's for a good play. They don't do that on third down.
They should. I would incorporate it on third down. If I had a cool thing, if I had a cool thing that looked like the horn, it'd be happening a lot.
Well,
we'd set up second and five. I'd blow the horn.
They added the skull chain. That thing's scary.
Yeah, it's awesome.
When you're in the building, you're like, ooh, this is like an Amway event gone wrong.
Well, anytime you get massive amounts of people in lockstep, in unity, chanting anything, it never tends to go well. It's Jeff Cameron Show, 97.9 ESPN Radio. Bowl, a coach, the coach, the one said Super Bowl just got fired. But that happened today in Philadelphia. Doug Peterson out. They went 4-11-1. Carson Wentz was horrible. Peterson went in his career in Philadelphia 42-37. He did have a second losing season this year, so in a short period of time, he's had a couple losing seasons. You really do realize how hard it is to be successful in the NFL, and that you juxtapose disappointments with career records, for example, and understand consistency matters. Mike Tomlin has never had a losing season in Pittsburgh. You know, I mean, and here's a guy that just won a Super Bowl, and he's had two of them, and just got fired. So there's something to be said for that. Now, they've got some retooling to do over there in Pittsburgh, but a lot of times you lose, you know, relationships and things begin to falter. Guys leave, guys get hurt, and trying to rekindle whatever magic you had can be very, very difficult. I'll always look back and think to myself, how in the world did Doug Peterson win a Super Bowl with Nick Foles? Because you've seen Nick Foles before that Super Bowl, and Nick Foles after it, and he's largely kind of sucked everywhere.
And yet they would score 50 or 60 a game if you gave him enough possessions.
It was unreal. Like, that guy played in a way that you've never seen him play anywhere else at any point. It's really quite remarkable. It was a marriage made in heaven until it wasn't, and there's that. They said about this was that the separation comes on the heels of a report, Chris Mortensen still breaking news, shockingly, that the relationship between
Mortensen.
Yeah, you were looking for it.
I was waiting. The relationship between Peterson and Wentz was, quote unquote, fractured beyond repair.
Mortensen.
Peterson said about that, look, Carson and I are fine. I can't speak for him, but from my standpoint, we're fine. It's something that we're going to have to build upon. Well, no, you're not going to build upon it. That is that. It is over.
Mortensen.
And I don't know who's to blame for that, but I know Mortensen. Carson Wentz is broken. He looks like a guy that is looking for the bailout button before the play even gets going.
They all want out. They're all like, y'all, somebody else put these uniforms on. I got to put a different pullover on if I'm Doug Peterson. If I'm Wentz, I'm like, give me a different helmet. Any helmet at all.
It is the Carson Wentz thing is interesting. What will happen with him? What it looks like moving forward? Because he was an MVP candidate the year they won the Super Bowl. He was great. And then he gets hurt, and he's been butt sorry. Well, actually, towards the end of last year, he wasn't. This year, all butt sorry. All just a big stew of butt sorry.
Last year, he was like, on my shoulders, boys. I'm going to get us there, hopefully.
Yeah.
And then he just couldn't. He ran out of gas, and they ran out of receivers. Like, they had dudes. You thought Jameis had it rough in Week 16 and Week 17 last year. My God.
That still went all-time bad.
That was Wentz all season.
Yeah, it was. It was a toughie.
Like, is Alshon Jeffrey still under contract with Philly? He is, okay. So he exists. He is a thing in the NFL. He's a player.
Riding out that deal and collecting paychecks is what he's doing.
And it took everything Carson had to get through last year. This year he's like, oh, no, sir.
Who you got tonight, man? I guess we're going to have to say Alabama for the record. I think we both agree with that. Although we do think also that Ohio State could make this a game. I sure hope so. I really hope so.
I'll go with Ohio State to be different, but I don't believe it. I think it will be. I mean, the chances are, again, Alabama doesn't have to do anything spectacular out of character to win this game. Ohio State does a little bit.
I just want to see a close game in the fourth quarter. I'm having a hard time getting there in my mind, but maybe.
It could. I mean, Florida gave Alabama a game.
Yeah. It's a score festival if it's close, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Which means tonight, fourth quarter gets underway. Tied at 17, everybody. good work out of you. Good work, Matthew. Be well, everybody. Have a great night. Do we have the game? Or do we? We do. Mm-hmm. We've got the game for you right here on 97.9 ESPN Radio. So if you're out and about working, moving around, doing whatever you got to do, and you want to hear the game, you can listen to it at ESPN Tallahassee. Be good. Talk to you tomorrow. Be well, everybody.